And good evening from Tampa, St. Pete, a metropolitan area of 2.5 million. This is a huge sports weekend. This afternoon belonged to the Devil Rays across the bridge in St. Pete. Evan Longoria, a couple of home runs, and the Rays beat the White Sox in game one of the ALDS. But tonight, under the lights belongs to the Bulls. Matt Grothy, their tough playmaking quarterback, and USF trying to protect their number 10 ranking and their perfect season so far against the upset-minded Pittsburgh Panthers of Dave Wansett. A Big East matchup coming up now. Welcome once again to ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Applebee's. We come to you from Raymond James Stadium, home of Super Bowl 43, the Buccaneers, and of course, the USF Bulls. Their fans are ready. First home game since they knocked off Kansas, and that's what's helped catapult USF once again up into the top 10. And welcome, Chris Fowler, Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Aaron Andrews will join us. USF guys starting to become more established. It was a year ago this time, they were ranked number 2. And then on a Thursday night at Rutgers, the face plant. They lost 3 in a row. So Grothy says the focus this year, get up there and stay up there. Handle the situation better than they did. They're the hour at number 10 because of all the upsets last weekend. But keep in mind, guys, all the teams in white, they're going to play each other in some combination. If USF can keep winning, and they should be favored in all or most of their games, they're going to find themselves right in that BCS mix, perhaps undefeated out of the Big East.
Yeah, but you know, the one good thing about it is they have learned from the past, especially Jim Leavitt. Here's a football coach that knows now how to prepare his team to handle emotionally the rankings. So he's come out and he said, fellas, focus on your game and yourselves. Jim Leavitt, there he is running the guys full of energy and intensity, and that's what makes him special. The players here love their head football coach, and they play for the guy, but they have to be very worried tonight because Pitt already has a loss, so they're playing with their backs against the wall. They don't want another loss. They got to focus, though, South Florida on their own game.
And on the other side of the field, Pitt came into the season ranked, and they stumbled against Bowling Green that first week. A lot of people wrote this football team off, but they've strung some wins together, and they got a great opportunity here tonight, if they get this win, to really get back on track this season. And if you look at the driving force behind Pitt's offense, it has to be their running back, LeSean McCoy, and he's a good one. Last year, set a Big East freshman rushing record with 1,328 yards. He's a big back, but he's got that sprinter speed. He had his best game of the season this past Saturday against Syracuse, so he's feeling it. This USF defense has to do a good job tackling in this football game. If not, guys, we could have yet another upset here on Thursday night.
We've had 4 in a row. They call McCoy shady. He's pretty slippery, tough to tackle, and he's going to be the focus for Jim Leavitt's defense tonight. Here's the coach with Aaron Andrews.
Coach, look, there's been a lot of talk with Pittsburgh about their back. LeSean McCoy rushing for 149 yards last week. How do you plan to stop him tonight?
Well, you know, he's a good back, and it's not going to be easy. He's going to get some yards. I don't think there's any question about that. You know, we've got to play within the framework of our defense and certainly have great pursuit and get off blocks. And, I mean, there's no secret to the whole deal. You know, he's a good back, and we just got to do the best we can, you know, with, like I said, just getting to the ball carrier.
A lot of people are curious to see how you'll handle, the team will handle the ranking. What have you preached to them about that?
We don't talk much about it because, you know, they've been around long enough now that knows that where you're at right now doesn't mean, you know, a whole lot. Every head coach says the same thing. Everybody says it's all how you finish at the end of the year. That's what really matters.
I don't see any blood. How many guys have you headbutted?
Only about 16.
Thanks.
No fooling, that is the pregame routine. Leavitt's skull against his players' helmets. The Bulls are the measuring stick program in the Big East. Pittsburgh tries to make it 5 straight upsets on Thursday night. Kickoff coming up. Respect to you guys.
All right, Chris, strangely enough, the way Leavitt gets ready for the game is the same thing that Mark Lou and I do. We headbutt each other. Lou often sheds a little blood there before it starts. I don't know if you guys have noticed, but our country is in a bit of a financial crisis that our leaders are endeavoring right now to try to solve through a bailout program. And it has extended to college football. Oklahoma State benefactor T. Boone Pickens has lost like a gazillion dollars, meaning he only has like 10 gazillion left. And it has put on hold some of Oklahoma State's expansion plans, but there are other financial issues extending into college football right now, guys. I want you guys to take me through a few of these. For instance, does Vanderbilt, Lou, have a credit crisis as they get ready to take on Auburn?
Oh, no, I think Vanderbilt is a great buy on a short term. They haven't shown a profit since 1982 when they played Air Force the All-America game. But they're going to have a profit this year, but in the long run, you don't want any part of that stock. And incidentally, while we're talking about expenses, my property devaluated one-third, but my property taxes has not gone down. Not fair.
I'm Reese Davis, and I approve that message and second it also. You see, Vanderbilt's been number one in turnover margin. They're last in the SEC in offense and defense. We'll see the Commodores against Auburn on Saturday night. All right, now, there's also the whole Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac problem, too. There have been teams that have been extended too much credit, Mark.
Yeah, I think there are a couple of teams. I think when you look at one, you've got to look at Georgia, obviously. Georgia's been extended a lot of credit. They were preseason number one. They were dropped back to number three. Then they got crushing. How about USC? There's some people up here on this desk that really thought USC had the best talent in the country, thought they were the number one team in the nation, thought that this was Pete Carroll's best team.
You are the king of Freddie Mac, USC.
Well,
the mortgage crashed last
Thursday. Poor clothes on this team now because the way they played at Oregon State. The other team with the Georgia Bulldogs, as I mentioned, getting shut out 31-0 in the first half against Alabama in their home stadium. They need to be foreclosed upon.
I wouldn't give you a loan if I was president of Freddie Mac.
Which team is most in need of a rescue package right now, Lou?
Oh, I think Wisconsin. If they could just get rescue against Ohio State. You know, you have to understand this. Since 1993, for the last 15 years, they've shown a tremendous profit. Great team. But against Michigan, they're up 19-0 at halftime, and they come back and they lose the game. If they can get some help and get by Ohio State, I think that they will be fine and be able to stand on their own for the rest of the year. But they need some help against Ohio State.
They needed help taking care of the ball and lining up properly late against Michigan as well. Okay, I know that everybody's trying to reassess their portfolio right now, make sure that everything is safe. And I understand that T-bills maybe at the moment only returning maybe 97 cents on the dollar, but it's a good, sound investment. That, you know, it's something that's not going to lose a lot. Eventually, it's going to pay off big time. Who is college football's version of the T-bill?
Well, you can go with Mack Brown. He wins 10 games or more every season. You can go with big game Bob Stoops, number one team in the country. But the team I'm going with, the defending national champions. What a safe bet. Les Miles. You look at LSU, the way they played the entire season. They run the ball with Charles Scott. Doesn't matter who's at quarterback. I told you guys Jarrett Lee should be the starter from day one. You didn't believe me. Solid offensive line. Solid defensive line. They just come out and they perform each and every week up to high expectations, and no one expects them to come out and be really flashy, but they get the job done. And the good thing about it, if you take LSU as the T-bomb, guess what? You get a free hat in the bargain.
I tell you, what a true politician. The only guy I know has got two mouths. And he's freaked out both of them with forked tongues.
Well, you know, I think the thing is that he is like a politician because he forgets the record and just says what's expedient at the moment.
No, right? Whatever's hot, just keep moving forward, baby.
Well, something to watch for this weekend, something that hasn't happened in 30 years, could very well happen on Saturday night. Missouri's going to Nebraska. The Tigers haven't won in Lincoln since 1978. Now, Missouri has had some memorable finishes and some heartbreaks as well over the years against the Cornhuskers.
Third down. Frost to the middle. On the deflection. Nebraska's a point away from tying the game. The deflection is caught. The fans have broken into the end zone.
A 1997 Chevin Wiggins kick to Matt Davidson gave Nebraska the 45-38 victory in overtime. Scott Frost's team went on to get a share of the national championship in 1997. Now, those are some of the glory days from the Nebraska-Missouri rivalry. From Missouri, that's 1978 in Lincoln when James Wilder went in for the winning touchdown. When you look at this game right now, the artists formerly known as the Blackshirts would appear to be ill-equipped to slow down Missouri.
They definitely are, and they struggled last week against a Virginia Tech offense that was 112th in the nation. They gave up 35 points to them. Chase Daniel comes to town with the Missouri Tigers. Not only that, the 12 touchdowns, one interception. He's been spectacular on the season, but directing this offense, what's been extremely impressive to me is he's gone through the entire season thus far without going through a series going 3 and out. That is hard to do. He continues to move the chains every time he's in at the quarterback.
No, that is impressive. But Missouri is impressive for a lot of reasons. You talk about Jeremy Maclin. They have two Heisman candidates. But you know what I like? I like Gary Pinkel, the coach. He played at Kent State, where I played, 1973, won a championship under Don Jay. He won at Toledo. The guy knows how to win.
He played with you in 1973?
No. I was there. I wish.
Hey, you know, and one thing, too, Missouri's defense probably needs to improve a little bit. Yes. Pinkel was here at ESPN last week and talked about how the return of William Moore to full health still believes they can be a really good defense. Our game is coming up in just a little while. Pittsburgh and South Florida coming up in just a few moments. What are you expecting to see tonight?
Well, South Florida can continue to play their defense without their star, George Selvey. They held North Carolina State to just 26 rushing yards. I think that's going to be key for them against the Pittsburgh Panthers rushing attack.
All you Pittsburgh fans that put that Mark May sign up, remember this. He picked South Florida. Unbelievable loyalty.
This is my eighth year on scholarship at ESPN. I was only in Pittsburgh 4 years.
But you made more in Pittsburgh than you do here.
Easy.
Statue of limitations.
Yeah.
Okay, it's all gone now. Pittsburgh and South Florida coming up in just a little bit. Ask Dr. Lou coming up at halftime as well. In fact, look at the sensation that's sweeping the nation.
Oh.
Somebody need a pep talk? I'm sure somebody will get it. Bulls and the Panthers coming up momentarily, and you'll get a chance to see Matt Grothy, one of the most dynamic quarterbacks in the country, leading Jim Levitt's team. Wanstead trying to pull the upset. Both trendy picks to win the Big East this year. We'll see who gets a leg up. Coming up.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Cargill. We collaborate, create, and succeed with our customers. Wrangler, real, comfortable jeans. And ESPN Game Plan. Saturday, catch Florida State, Miami, and Florida, Arkansas.
As you can see, this isn't your typical Midwestern farm. The reason lies 6,000 miles away, in Japan, where a producer of specialty eggs needed corn for feed grown to precise standards. Cargill identified the producer's needs, then introduced an Illinois farmer to grow the exact corn needed and developed a system to ship it separately, connecting the farmer with a Japanese customer who was very appreciative. This is how Cargill works with customers.
I'm comfortable in jeans that are tough. I'm comfortable in Wrangler. Real comfortable.
Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans. Satisfaction guaranteed. Wrangler. Real comfortable jeans.
We are in a state of crisis.
My fellow citizens, like so many of you, I have gone blind.
Oh, lady, don't forget your voice.
I won't forget your face.
Blindness, rated R, everywhere tomorrow.
This telecast is available in high definition. Brought to you by Pioneer's new Kuro.
It's a beautiful evening inside Raymond James Stadium in Tampa as the Bulls try to protect the perfect record and the number 10 ranking. But this is Thursday Night Football, where strange events occur and anything is possible. Just ask the Commodores, Tar Heels, Buffaloes, or Beavers. Fires downfield, has a man, jump ball, touchdown! V stands for victory. Has a man wide open, and Brandon Tate will not be caught. And Carolina looking for that landmark road win. Hawkins rolling out, takes a shot downfield, touchdown Smith! And the students creating a mob scene on the field. Almost intercepted, the caught for a touchdown! And there will be a humongous party in Corvallis tonight. So three home underdogs have pulled upsets in recent weeks. The Bulls run out, led by the sprinting head coach, Jim Levitt. They, of course, come on as the favorites to protect this house. These many believe the two teams to beat in the Big East, although Pittsburgh does have a loss. And Dave Wanstead knows that if his team can pull off the upset here tonight, folks will forget about the loss to the opener. He's with Aaron Andrews.
Well, Coach, you mentioned this game isn't one yet that you need the mousetraps, the gimmicks, motivational.
Look at this crowd. Look at the atmosphere. It's fantastic. No, our guys are excited about playing. We've had a good week on a short week, and we need a game like this to find out where we're at.
Over the past 2 years, quarterback Matt Grothy has made some pretty big plays against you guys to win past two games. How do you stop this guy tonight?
Well, you're not going to stop him. We hope to contain him. I think the difference the last 2 years, we've made more bad plays than they have. That's what we got to do, eliminate the bad plays.
All right, Coach, thanks so much. Chris, we got two pumped-up coaches here tonight. Are you kidding me?
Absolutely pumped up, but they hope their teams can handle the occasion. You know, Wansett's team had to rally from 11 down to escape against Syracuse in their last game. They're not the most impressive 3-1 team, but they're 3-1.
They're living dangerously right now. They've strung some wins together, but what a test here tonight. This is the first ranked opponent they've played so far this season.
And Dave Wansett, he's an old offensive tackle. He's not going to get into the sprinting game with Levitt. He'll leave it to his players.
Yeah, Levitt says, I only coach because I'm too old to play. I wish I could play. I can't, so I'll do this as a fallback plan. The Bulls won the toss, deferred, so Delbert Alvarado will boot it away, and Pittsburgh will go on offense first. Ron Stevens Howling, Andre Wright are deep. This is Stevens Howling, the backup tailback. Bounces it, can't quite get the corner. And the Panthers will start from their 23-yard line. They're led out by Bill Stull, injured his thumb last year, had to sit and watch, very frustrating. He's a guy that they ask basically not to lose the game, but they might be more aggressive with him tonight. Try to take some shots, Jesse,
if you can. They expect to take some shots. This is a big game for Bill Stull here tonight because when the shots get called, if it's not open downfield, he's got to be disciplined enough to check it down or throw it away. They cannot afford bad plays.
They had three crucial interceptions in the loss at home to USF last year. Two of them taken back for touchdowns. Stull was not the quarterback in that game. Very first play, and there's some confusion, and Stull will be hit in the backfield by Keon Wilson, the middle linebacker. So Wansett talked about making bad plays and handling the environment they don't in the first play.
Well, you know what, in the short week, you know, you've got a lot of enthusiasm. Wansett tried to temper the enthusiasm of his team, but this is a big game. This is a setup game for him to find out where they are for the season.
It sure is. We talked about Bill Stull earlier. He's a very emotional quarterback. He's a guy that, you know, when bad plays happen, it tends to kind of wear on him a little bit. He kind of wears his emotions on his sleeves. He's got to put these plays behind him.
Second and 13, Derek Kinder, the top receiver, goes in motion. Almost intercepted. It was broken up at the line of scrimmage. Bowie got a hand on it. And now it's going to be third and long.
And, you know, when you talk about an opening series here, Stahl's not a guy that's going to put the team on his shoulder and beat him with a passing game. But he's got to be quicker and smarter with this.
That's one thing the defensive ends from USF do such a good job at in games. They're able to pin their ears back and get upfield, get those hands up to knock balls down.
And third and 13. Pressure from the edge. A shovel pass. McCoy has it. This is Shady McCoy, but he can't make enough Bulls miss to get the first down. Danny Verpale, the safety there on the stop. Panthers go three and out.
When you talk about starting the game for Pitt, they felt like Wansted did, that he could come out here, spread this group out, and have success early, Jesse, especially with this offensive line taking advantage of the upfield pressure.
Yeah, and there's so much speed on USF on the defensive side of the ball, and we saw good examples of that here in these last three plays.
Dave Brightus, who's a black belt in karate and also a mixed martial arts fighter, tough punter, and he'll kick it away to Marcus Edwards of the Bulls. It's almost blocked. They run into him, and here comes the flag. There's going to be a penalty on USF. I don't know how they didn't block it. They were all over Brightus, didn't get the ball, slam into the punter. And he's a tough guy, so you don't want to slam into him, but you better run away.
Well, they got there too fast. he overran the block angle. You know, and everybody tells you, take the ball, take your hand, put it where the foot is. He just overran the leg.
Yeah, you got to be better about that. As a player, you have to understand where that punter is, where the leg's going to extend to. Like you said, Craig, go for the ball, but stay out of that swinging, that arc from the punter.
And it was Quentin Washington. He was there, as you said, in plenty of time to make the block. Kind of flinched. They kind of came away from the leg of the punter. So that moves the ball to the 43-yard line. First big mistake of the game goes to USF. McCoy, the tailback in the I formation. Panthers do a lot of shifting pre-snap, kind of NFL style. Matt Cavanaugh is the offensive coordinator. Give it to McCoy. USF has very good rush defense stats, but they haven't played anybody quite like Pittsburgh's offense, and McCoy comes off his first 100-yard game this year as the impact player.
They are hoping that they can go right at this USF defense and punish them with the speed and quickness and power of McCoy.
If McCoy's the thunder, then LaRod Stevens-Howling's the lightning. Expect him to get a lot of carries here tonight also against USF.
Derek Kinder in an ACL tear last year, just now finding his form. He's the top receiver with 19 catches coming in. And jumping off sides in there. It looked like big Keith McCaskill, the tackle, and see if he was drawn. Nope.
Pence, number 91, 5-yard penalty, second down.
This is a very emotional defense when they play here at home, USF. They kind of feed off this crowd, which it may not be a sellout, but they make a lot of noise here. But just a little keyed up, too keyed up.
It's a nice job by Bill Stahl changing up the snap count when you're playing on the road in hostile environments. Mix it up and try to quiet this crowd down.
You see George Selby, the fine pass rusher, on the sidelines. He was going to try to go tonight. He's had a high ankle sprain. Missed last week's game. Second and manageable, but down goes Stahl. And that was McCaskill making up for his mental error with the sack.
Well, USF's defensive line, they felt the challenge coming their way tonight. Everybody's talked about how Pitt was going to get after the D-line. Six men come. Offensive lineman not passing off. Mistake on the left side by Jason Pinkston, the left tackle.
And there's Keon Wilson also coming on the blitz. They are all over that Panther offensive line in the early going. Goes from second and medium to third and long again. This time they rush only four and they dump it off to McCoy, but a long way to go with the first down. He gets nowhere near it. They're not going to have much success if they're third and 13 all night.
They got to do a better job, obviously, of setting themselves up to convert these third downs. On that last screen pass, though, LeSean McCoy caught the football. There were no offensive linemen out in front of him to block.
That's a problem in a screen.
That's a little bit of a problem in the screen.
I never like seeing that as a running back. I always hated to see no big fellas with me.
What's going on?
We'll try this again now. Brightus. Marcus Edwards deep for USF. This time they don't come after it. Try to set up the return. Edwards inside his 10. Twist forward to the 18. So Matt Grothy and the USF offense will get their first possession after a 48-yard punt.
It's time saving energy costs less. It's time guaranteed low prices got even lower. We know times are tough. That's why the Home Depot is lowering the cost on hundreds of items throughout the store, including energy-efficient ones like ceiling fans and programmable thermostats. So the products that save you the most money will save you even more. The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Let's talk merger. Beep. Ned's phone. Ned doesn't have AT&T, which means no bars here in Finland. So when Ned's boss called to say not to mention the merger, Ned, don't hint at the merger, Ned, don't even think about the word merger, Ned, it isn't finalized and everyone will freak out. We didn't get that call.
For the best coverage, switch to AT&T. More bars in more places. Get our exclusive LG Shine for only $49.99 and get one free.
Welcome to Progressive.com. How can I help you?
Well, I haven't shopped for car insurance in a while.
And you're worried that you've been paying too much, right?
Yeah. So how can I know I'm getting a good deal?
We can compare your Progressive Direct rate with other top companies.
Wow. Seriously?
Yeah. Look at the deal we just got him.
That's a new pair of shoes.
Yeah, or a big tricked out name tag.
Making sure you get a great deal. Now that's Progressive. Call or click today.
Will it be another upset-filled week of Cinderellas and last-second drama? ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Hampton Hotels. Auburn-Vanderbilt, Saturday at 6 Eastern. Then at 9, number 4 Missouri battles Big 12 rival Nebraska. College football lives here.
First possession for USF coming up. They're led by the junior quarterback from Lakeland, Florida, Matt Grothy. Been a starter since his freshman year. Also leads the team in rushing. He's got quicks. He's tough. Accurate thrower. Good touch. Not a huge arm or all that, quick release.
Yeah, but Pitt wants their defense to make sure they push him to the perimeter. They don't want him running north and south on him. They want to see if they can turn his shoulders and get him sideways. They don't feel like he's as effective outside.
He's just got a knack for making plays, doesn't he? Not a physically imposing guy. Under 6 foot tall. Jamar Taylor is the setback. They fake it to him in the first play, and Grothy looks downfield, gets to the perimeter, and fires complete. This diving catch there by Cedric Hill, the tight end. The impact players for the Bulls, of course, besides their quarterback, is Jake Griffin, the center.
Yeah, I like Jake because he's an alligator hunter. Loves it, man. So he's going to be hunting some defensive linemen tonight, but he's a good, smart guy up front. Gets him in the right call.
Jesse Hester really has the confidence right now, and Matt Grothy leads this team in receptions with 22 heading into tonight.
And there is Jamar Taylor. He's a sophomore. Speedy, their best all-around back, but they'll shuttle backs in and out all night. They use lots of receivers and lots of backs in this offense. That was Taurus Johnson. He's their leading receiver. They've had 15 different guys catch passes, 14 different players run the ball, 11 different players score touchdowns already in the first, five games.
Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator at USF, tells his receivers before the game, I don't know which of you guys are going to catch balls here tonight. We'll just go the way the game goes.
They've got five receivers, three to the right, two at the top of the formation. And second and seven, Grothy has time, fires, and drops. Right off the number nine of the senior tight end Hill.
Well, he also says this, Greg Gregory does, the offensive coordinator. If you fumble the footballs running back, you're out of the game. And if you drop passes, they're not coming back to you either.
That's the thing about having a lot of depth. You make a mistake, you might sit and watch it. Yeah, Gregory says that they don't really have an offensive system. They just have a kind of a conglomeration of stuff. And we'll see what he can dial up on third and seven. Third and 12.
That playbook ball really shrinks.
On the offense, number 65, five-yard penalty, third down.
He said he feels good, Gregory, about third and seven or eight. He feels they got a lot of stuff in their offense they can call on that down and distance, but third and 12.
Yeah, they do very well throwing the football kind of in the short to intermediate ranges. They're comfortable there. Unfortunately, third and 12, again, that playbook, not that many calls to convert these plays.
Panthers show pressure. That's Scott McKillop, their linebacker, right over the center. And he's coming on the blitz. And Grothy can't get away. Got away from the first man, but that Panther pass rush, Greg Romeus. Rashad Duncan, the tackle, got there too.
Dave Wanstead believes the defensive line that is too deep here at Pitt is outstanding. He could not wait, Jesse, tonight to see them unleash their talent.
Absolutely not. And Greg Romeus, one of those guys, got really long arms. He's really tough to block because he engages and can keep the lineman off of him. And you saw a good example of that right there.
Alvarado, who used to be the kicker and the punter, now just handles the punting, boots it away. And a fair catch is called for by Aaron Berry. So both defenses, quick and stout in the early going, scoreless in Tampa.
For the price of lunch in a bag, how about a real lunch instead? With people and silverware and lots of choice. Applebee's Pick and Pair Lunch Combos, starting at just $5.99. Over 75 combinations of soups, salads, sandwiches, and pasta. From grilled shrimp and spinach salad to three cheese chicken penne. Try finding lunch like that at a drive-thru. Applebee's Pick and Pair Lunch Combos, starting at $5.99. It's the best meal and the best deal in the neighborhood.
Red.
When you want to get away.
Both.
Enterprise will pick you up and get you going to romantic weekends. Pick Enterprise. We'll pick you up.
Not only is the new Mazda 6 fuel efficient, but in terms of power and room, it flat out beats Camry and Altima. Hey, we're always up for a good fight. The totally, completely, 100% new Mazda 6. At your Mazda dealer now.
Right now, get the totally new Mazda 6 starting at just $19,220.
You've been activated. Disobey and you die.
How are you doing this? How are you seeing us right now?
We are everywhere. You can't run, Jerry.
Eagle Eye, rated PG-13, now playing.
T is for Talladega. T stands for tenaciously tearing through traffic at the thrilling, tension-filled, transcendent track of all tracks. This week, in a tremendous three-way battle at the top, Jimmy Johnson tangles with Carl Edwards and Greg Biffle in pursuit of his third title. In the chase, T is for being thunderstruck at Talladega. And that's that. The Amp Energy 500 at Talladega, Sunday at 1 Eastern on ABC.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood. And in part by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. We'll pick you up.
Well, the four of us and the talent side of things were preparing for the telecast in our notes. Our crew was out there on the beach. That was Lisa Menzies beating all the guys in the ring toss over. That's a nice. See, we were working too hard to have that kind of.
We're just trying to work here. You know, yeah. We got a game.
Yeah, there's a guy getting ready with a headgear on, though.
You never know what you're going to see down here. It's a festive scene for the Bulls home games. Second possession for the Panthers. McCoy is the tailback. He's got it on the delay. LeSean McCoy weaving his way through traffic. A very hard-earned 7 yards. Bowie gets him.
One thing that'll be interesting tonight is USF's run defense is fourth best in the country. They're giving up just a little bit over 58 yards
that,
a game. You know, this is a different animal they're seeing tonight. You know, it's different when you play UCF, FIU, you play Kansas, who runs the football 10 times or less, Craig.
And McCoy, we need to watch McCoy tonight to see if he's running hard for the 4 and 5 yard gains, not the 20-yard burst. They've been working on that hard.
Officially 6 yards on first down. McCoy has it again. He can't get away. Off the edge, Jerome Murphy, the corner with the stop. You know, the Bulls are not on the field very much as a defense. They keep the ball a lot, and their opponents have only had it about 27 minutes a game, and they don't run that many plays. That's why the stats are pretty good.
Well, the stats are good right there for two reasons. One, if you're for USF, their defense came up secondary strong. Two, from Pitt, McCoy's got to lower his shoulder and get something out of that.
This USF defense heading into tonight's game has held opponents 50% of their drives. It's been three and out. They're able to get off the football field.
You can see they're doing it without the star pass rusher, George Selby. And third and three. Stull, a poor throw. Tried to get it to Kinder, threw it behind him. And after a promising 6-yard gain on first down, off the punt.
That's one key coming into tonight's game also. Dave Wanstead told us when they get into third and two, third and three, third and five, and wide receivers are open, Bill Stahl has to hit those passes.
You know what? There'll be some changes in this offense throughout the night that'll give them a chance to have some open plays. They've got a nice game plan for it, but right now USF's covering them up.
Edwards back to receive the punt. They come after it and block it. The Bulls scoop it up and head for the end zone. Touchdown. Theo Wilson takes it to the house.
He's on the inside. Nobody's there, Jesse. Somebody has to account right there. You got three back there. 83. Look out.
This is twice on three punts now that USF has come through clean, and a great job by Theo Wilson just being aware. Scoop and score.
Yeah, it's Carlton Sinclair, actually, number 31, not 21, who scooped it up. But problems with the Panthers and the special teams in the early going. This time they got to the football. No pulling back as they approach the punter.
Well, the protection guys back there are designed to block inside out on pressure. There was plenty of pressure coming.
Will the Wildest continue this weekend in college football? ESPN Saturday afternoon. Joppa, the sixth-ranked undefeated Lions, take on the Boilermakers in West Lafayette. That's noon Eastern time on ESPN HD. That's they use this punt formation that they get from the Gators, Jesse. It's the spread formation. It leaves some pretty wide splits, and the Bulls have figured that out.
Yeah, it's one of those things, I think, when you're in that spread punt formation, if not everybody is sound and guys are missing assignments, you can get some clear-cut lanes right at the punter, right in front of the punter.
Stevens howling. Barrels across the 30. That's the kind of early special teams mistake that Wanstead frankly feared in this game.
Well, you just have to count bodies. 1-2, 1-2. This guy here, block out. These two back here, they took the same guy. So you've got a problem with your counting numbers. 2-on-1 leaves one open. Can't do that.
And that was Washington who roughed the punter the first time, making no mistake that time. Sinclair with the touchdown. And now his team, which has played from behind almost all year, faces a 7-0 deficit here in Tampa. The first down throw for Stull, and the slant is complete. It's a short gain. Jonathan Baldwin is a true freshman. Second catch of the season.
Boy, Jesse, I don't know about that, but you know, when you open up and just look right where you're going with it and you're patting the football, it's telling everybody to go cover somebody over there.
Yeah, you know, Bill Stull is going to have to do a good job in this game of using his eyes and getting the football out quickly. We mentioned it earlier, Craig. This USF D line, they can get up the field and into the backfield.
Let's see what they can do on second and three. Nothing's been easy for Pittsburgh, even when they've gotten a decent gain on first down. This is Conridge Collins, the physical fullback, and knee hammers for a first down at the 45. Keon Wilson on the stop.
Obviously now it's up to Dave Wanstead to figure out what's going on. Trying to figure out who's coming from where, who's counting, and who's responsible. You've got to count bodies. It's really simple.
You know, what killed Pitt last year in this matchup against USF was interceptions. And Pat Bostic, the backup quarterback, threw two to the house. He almost threw another one, but this Pitt team, they can't turn it over. You can't afford block punts getting scooped up to score either. You've got to play more sound to stay in this football game.
Yeah, Pittsburgh led in that game, Jesse, 14-7, and the Bulls reeled off 24 straight points at Heinz Field. Here's a first down. They'll take a shot downfield, but way overthrown. He's trying for T.J. Porter. Nothing there.
Poor execution. When you see all the green jerseys back there, nobody's fooled on the play action. That means to me the offensive line is standing straight up.
And if you're going to take a lot of shots as an offense, your quarterback better have time. And so far in this first quarter, guys, Bill Stull has not had a lot of time to set up. It's going to be very difficult to push the football downfield with the kind of time Bill Stull has gotten so far tonight.
Stevens Howland is the tailback behind the fullback Collins. Baldwin in motion. And Stevens Howland is small guy, just 5'7", 180. But we've seen a lot of small guys do really well on Thursday night the last couple of weeks, haven't we? It's almost an advantage to be under 5'8 these days.
Kind of hide back there and hope that you're not 6'1 or 2. I think Pete Carroll would echo your sentiments there.
Well, it's funny, Craig. You and I were talking about it. We were watching Lerod Stevens Howling on tape. And for a guy that's 5'7", 180, he runs a lot tougher than his size would indicate. He runs almost as if he thinks he's 230.
Yeah.
He's a bruiser for a little guy.
Another third and long. We need seven. Stull wants to go downfield, throws it up, and running under the ball is Jonathan Baldwin for a touchdown. First career touchdown for the true freshman from Aliquippa, 52 yards.
There are no real fast guys on this offense at wide receiver, Jesse, but the double moves and the time to throw the deep ball is what they have to work into it.
They're going to have to try to find creative ways to get downfield. You see the true freshman, Jonathan Baldwin, on the double move, and a beautiful throw by Bill Stull just to float it up and over and has allowed his receiver to run underneath it for the touchdown.
It's a true freshman beating a senior corner in Tyler Roberts. Connor Lee never missed a PAT in his career. Just snuck it through the upright. I almost put the jinx on him. He's 86 of 86. That was pretty close.
Well, let me tell you what was close was Stahl probably being replaced at quarterback if he didn't make a big play.
Now, this is a pretty big play, and the Panthers, after the punting gaffe, tie the score at 7.
to gifted undergraduates, to scholars awarded the highest honors, home to talented and fearless athletes, to students who reach out to their communities. The University of Pittsburgh, leader in education, pioneer in research, partner in regional development.
So Pittsburgh native Bill Stull hooks up with Jonathan Baldwin, who comes from Tony Dorsett's hometown of Aliquippa, PA. The greatest Panther of them all, with apologies to Mark May and Mike Ditka and Frelick and Hugh Green.
A lot of good names on there.
Aliquippa's produced a lot of good football players over the years.
What's the name of your hometown, Jesse?
Nepean, Ontario.
Nepean.
Famous for Steve Yzerman of the National
Nepean.
Hockey League. Nepean.
Nepean. All right.
Nepean.
Nepean.
Good.
Okay.
All right.
Is that near Toronto or way out in the middle of nowhere?
No, that's kind of near Ottawa. A lot of igloos, a lot of hockey rinks.
Okay. Igloos, we call them igloos. I guess I'm off on that.
Oh, man, you wouldn't igloos. Tell. Yeah, you wouldn't be able to tell by the way I skate.
We'll have to go there when he's there.
Oh, yeah. Bring your leather jacket. Metal, man.
Do they let you wear those kind of shoes in Nepea?
I'd slide all over the place.
Luke Friggs is a kickoff specialist for Pittsburgh. Dontavia Bogan has it. And Bogan into traffic, stopped short of the 30-yard line. Jim Leavitt made about $75,000 when he took over this head coaching job a dozen years ago. To say things were Spartan is the all-time understatement. That's the Ponderosa, the trailer that they operated out of. They got six showers in there. But they didn't just stay in there for a year or two. They were in there for like 6 or 7 years. And then they got this beautiful new complex about 4 years ago. Moved from Tampa Stadium to Raymond James. And he has a 2,000% salary increase at 20 times what he made back in his first year. That isn't bad these days, is it?
No, not at all. And he's earned every penny.
And he's had offers to go other places, big time places. But he loves it here in Tampa, and he loves the Bulls. There's a handoff in traffic. Mo Plancher gets his first carry. And they'll use a whole bunch of tailbacks tonight, try to find the right guy, the hot hand.
You know, this is a team and an organization right now that doesn't have a lot of individual superstars, so they have the team concept.
They can recruit skill in this state. There's lots of good receivers and running backs in the state of Florida, and you can usually find a pretty good quarterback who wants to run this offense. Yeah. Second and eight, that's McKillop again showing pressure up the middle, but he backs off. They rush just four. Brophy takes a shot downfield, lobs it up, and it's intercepted. A diving intercepted. DeSico was right there to collect the very poor throw. Carlton Mitchell, the intended receiver, but a mistake by Grothy, and momentum is switched.
Well, Matt Grothy came to the line of scrimmage, and he saw press man-to-man and thought he'd have a great opportunity on the corner route with Carlton Mitchell. He has to kind of anticipate this throw a little bit earlier than he'd like. He throws it way too far inside, though. That ball has to go to the sidelines, and DeSico does a nice job just getting underneath it, making a nice catch for the turnover.
Did he have to change the trajectory in the throw because of the rush?
Yes.
He looked like he had to change at the last minute to try to put some mark on it.
He couldn't follow through to get it to the outside.
Well, here come the Panthers with a wrinkle here. Greg Cross, the backup quarterback, is in for Stull. He's a runner who can also throw. Calls his own number and shows the toughness and the running ability. Picks up five. They have a little package for the junior. And he'll come in and run modified wildcat formation, but they say he'll also throw the ball too.
Yeah, and they've used Greg Cross only on two plays this year. They did it back against Iowa. One of the plays was a 17-yard touchdown run.
Good feet too.
The other play was a sack. So it's been a bit of a Jekyll and Hyde proposition so far.
Tonight a little different though. They're going to put him in there and leave him in there with the full offense to see how he handles it.
Now this is as expected. Ron Sitz had looked from about the third series, and it's right on schedule. Cross takes off. The hat comes flying out of the pile. Cross hit after about a 3-yard gain. Bowie, who's been active the defensive end on the stop. Is that the guy that lost the hat? No, that was Wilson.
This is a point right here now. If you're Dave Wanstead, you're thinking third and short, we better get it because I'm afraid to send my punt team back out there. You wonder if they got their blocking scheme down because they could have and should have had two, not just one block punt.
And And Stoll back in at quarterback on third and two. Looks left, fires incomplete. Hayward spying that slant route. They're looking for Carlton McGee, and a nice play to get over there. Tyrone McKenzie is their top tackler.
Bill Stoll gets lucky here. He tried to thread the needle, and Tyrone McKenzie, the outside linebacker, is just going to watch Bill Stoll's eyes. You see him right there. That ball goes right between McKenzie's hands. If that's caught, that's going six the other way, guys.
And then right off the face mask of the receiver. Hold on now. The Panthers are punting. Bulls peel back, don't go for the block, and it's a pretty short kick. Coming up for the fair catch is Edwards. So Pittsburgh, a three and out, cannot cash in on the Grothy interception. College football primetime presented by Hampton Hotels continues on Saturday night. Auburn and Vanderbilt, the undefeated 19th-ranked Commodores. We saw them get going by knockoff the Gamecocks. Game day will be there Saturday morning. The game's at 6 o'clock Eastern, Missouri-Nebraska. As the Tigers try for their first win in Lincoln since 78. Going in big favorites.
Hats off to Vanderbilt. They positioned themselves for a big game. Great opportunity. And have you guys over there with game day. Give them some love.
It'll be fun for the first time ever. They beat Ole Miss right before Ole Miss went to the Swamp and won. Mike Ford is the tailback, but Grothy is going to keep it. Lean forward for about 4 yards. Giovanni Chappelle on the stop.
You know, going back to that interception that Matt Grothy threw in the previous possession, he's done a very good job this year of taking care of the football. He's had interception problems in his first 2 years. He's done a better job of knowing when to throw the football away. On that last interception, though, just poor execution. You got to know to throw the football to the sidelines.
Ford, the back of the game now, is a sophomore. The leading rusher is a true freshman last year. And he's got it. A physical runner, but he can't turn the corner. Good penetration by the D-line there. Austin Ransom, the converted wide receiver. That's why he wears 86 there to make the tackle.
He's a good player. You know, Matt Grothy over the years has made a lot of big key plays for this offense. And Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator, says those mistakes, Jesse, he's got to be real careful that he doesn't trim the enthusiasm, the creativity of it.
Because he's one of those guys who's in the pocket, scrambling around, keeping his eyes downfield. He can make huge plays on the run. He's a great creative quarterback, and the coaches don't want to take that away from him.
See what he can do on third and four.
Get in there. Go get him.
Murphy throwing. It's complete. Fighting for first down yardage. Barely getting there is Bogan, the sophomore. McKillop on the tackle, but they get 6 yards and move the chains.
Well, that was a nice little assist by the umpire right there. Kind of got in McKillop's way. Yeah, seriously, works. You watch the umpire here, bottom right of your screen. He comes over to McKillop. Whoops. Get out of my way. I'm trying to hit somebody.
He wasn't going to get there anyway in time to stop the first down.
He may have hit him a little harder, though.
Well, the corner covering that play actually got picked by one of the USF receivers running upfield, so there's almost a double pick on that play.
There's a first down run for Ford. And originally signed with Alabama. Academic issues there, and he's found a home in Tampa. Scott McKillop on the tackle for Penn. McKillop is the guy that led the nation in tackles last year, almost 13. And he's just one of those natural tacklers as a linebacker. Just finds a way to get near the ball and then wraps up. Already got 40 tackles coming into this game. They fake the toss to Ford. Grothy has to dodge the rush. Spins away. Staying alive, and Matt Grothy takes off into Pittsburgh territory. Weaving to the 35. Defensive coordinator's nightmare.
If you're a teammate of Matt Grothy, you have to play to the whistle because you never know what's going to happen with him in the pocket. And Craig, his teammates do an unbelievable job of staying alive and getting great blocks for him.
And McKillop on the right side of the screen, the middle linebacker, he ran to one sideline, tried to get to the other side. Matt Grothy gained 15 pounds and lost him. If he's still carrying that 15, he wouldn't have done that.
Yeah, he got a little chubby after spring practice, and the coaches suggested that he go on a nice diet over the summer and do the plenty of the cardio, and he did.
And if he hadn't lost it heading into the game, he may have lost it on that play right there.
It is a cool night here, though, in Tampa. I mean, for Tampa, it's a cool night. But, yeah, he had to lose a little weight to make himself ready for football.
27-yard gain. He shows you that he can hurt a defense. Not just with the 8 or 10-yard runs. He can take it a long way. He's had an 80-yard run in his
career. He brought him back against Kansas early in the season, 20-3 down right before half. Big touchdown run.
It's time. Throws. Underneath. Caught. And spinning for a first down is Jesse Hester, Jr. He's really become productive. He and Brothy have a nice connection. 17 catches in his last three games coming in. So the end of the first quarter, the Bulls special teams give USF a lead. Pittsburgh responds with a touchdown pass. We're all even after one.
The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues on ABC, Sunday at 1 Eastern.
The kids have been wanting to go to the Safari theme park since last summer. So we used our City Cash Returns card to buy the tickets and stuff.
So cool.
It was great to get close to the animals. But not that close. Luckily, we used the cash we got back to help pay for some body work.
With your City Cash Returns card, earn unlimited cash back and get it mailed to you automatically. Whatever your story is, your City Cash Returns card can help you write it. Because City never sleeps.
This is not the Vietnam War you've read about. This is not the war you've seen. This is Vietnam the way it really happened. Gripping and brutal. Courageous and shocking. Real and unvarnished. See it for the first time ever in the razor-sharp clarity of DVD. It's Vietnam, an American history, the complete visual record of the war on DVD. You'll see rare footage shot on once-secret missions, filmed in the heat of combat and behind enemy lines. You'll finally get the whole picture, from Tonkin Gulf to the fall of Saigon. Operation Rolling Thunder, the siege of Khe Sanh, the Tet Offensive. This is Vietnam without the bias, without the spin. Digitally remastered on crystal clear DVD. Get Vietnam and American History on three DVDs for just $59.99. But wait, call with your credit card and you'll get an extra $20 off. That's nearly 8 hours of gripping footage for just $39.99. And that's not all. Call in the next 10 minutes and get free shipping and handling, an additional savings of nearly $10. From Air Cavalry to Jungle Patrol, from the Ho Chi Minh Trail to the Hanoi Hilton. This is no Hollywood movie. This is the real thing. Newsweek hailed it as riveting and powerful. The New York Times said it may change opinions about the war. Call now to get Vietnam and American History, 460 gripping minutes on three DVDs for just $39.99. Call in the next 10 minutes and we'll ship it for free. This is their story. This is our story. Call now for Vietnam and American History on DVD.
Call 1-800-709-2059 to order Vietnam and American History on three DVDs for $39.99 and receive free shipping when you use your credit card or order online at timelife.com/Vietnam.
What's so cool about ESPNU?
It's what's important to me.
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 It's college sports knowledge at my fingertips.
Awesome!
Take a closer look and develop your mind and spirit at ESPNU.
I love this place!
Body paint. Not a fan.
I think Jesse would say, speak for yourself.
Well, some wear it better than others. On third and short, this is Ford. A tough run. Mike Ford hurtling down to the 10, and here come three penalty flags on the play. They came in late in the run.
Holding on the offense. Number 89. 10-yard penalty.
third down.
You got the senior receiver, Torres Johnson. It wipes out a 14-yard gain.
Well, first of all, Jesse and I were sitting up here, and Greg Gregory has told us that on third and two, they've been terrible. They've been trying to run the football, so we're thinking pass.
Yeah. Like, and having said that, all of a sudden, now this penalty is going to set him back. You almost wonder if this USF offense, you know, still isn't built to maybe convert this. You got to be careful now, though, because now you're kind of bordering inside this 30-yard line. You want to stay in field goal position. Third and 11, a little bit different.
Now you see that Greg Gregory wants a timeout. Grothy calls it. And so it'll be third and three.
You know, some of that, when you wonder, that's a weird number for them. They said last year they went back and looked at all of their third and two situations, and they were 8 out of 10 when it was third and two. You know, they were throwing the football.
Right.
So this year they've been trying to, you know, square peg, round hole, and so, hey, well, okay, let's go back and let's throw it on third and two. And
they gassed him right there with Mike Ford. That was a huge hole for one of those short yardage third down situations. You don't expect to get those on
offense. When you go and tackle the linebacker, though, around the legs,
that helps the hole. Yeah. Especially downfield.
That's a problem.
Key thing, though, this momentum has been kind of pulled back and forth. Bulls with the crowd roaring, got the lead in the punt block, and Pittsburgh a nice answer. But now Grothy with the first real substantial drive of the game for the Bulls. Yards so far. This is play 9 on the drive on third and 2. They give it to Ford again. Drives the right side. Hard collision. He won't get there. Austin Ransom again, the converted receiver, ex-safety, now playing linebacker, but a very tough guy.
Well, when you're trying to kick out block, that means you're going to run up inside, right? And when you miss the kick out block and you try to bounce outside with the running, that usually equals no success.
That's over two right there on third and two on this team trying to convert them running the football. Craig, what you were just saying, we might start seeing USF go back to throwing it on these short conversions.
Micah Benani, the Brazilian-born freshman kicker, the hero of the Kansas game. He kicked the game winner with 000. It's blocked. And the Panthers special teams rise up and make a play. They try to lateral the ball, and they'll be knocked out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Wanstead says, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah. Redemption for the special teams.
I don't think he was talking about the lateral.
You don't think he was that excited about the,
not the lateral.
Big guys trying to make a play on the sidelines?
Outside here, you know, he is excited, though, about his special teams coming up making a play.
And that's now the fourth block for Pitt this year. They've only played four games heading into tonight. That's their fourth block already.
Would you have coached up lateral net ball like that right there?
Oh, yeah. I might have had a few words with my guy coming off the sidelines. Let's not get careless here, fellas. 7-7 football game.
As Aaron Berry, who's the starting corner, he came off the corner out of the starting blocks and made the block. McCoy fumbles the football. USF falls on it. Nobody can keep momentum in this football game for very long. That's a crucial mistake. Exactly what Wanstead talked about with Aaron in the pregame. The bottom of the pile coming up with the football. Number 42, Wilson, the linebacker.
I really believe McCoy's problems. Look how he swings his arms. This is a habit that he has. It's a terrible habit. When you're in traffic, you have to know the presence of mind of where the people are coming from. And you can't run for 15 big yards. You've got to worry about the short gains.
Terrell McClain forced the fumble. And so Grothy right back to work at the 34. Ben Williams is the tailback. He takes his turn in there, the senior from Lake Wales, Florida. And Grothy, a first down throw. Five, short gain. The completion in front of Berry, made by Jesse Hester Jr. Reese, let's check with you tonight.
All right, Chris, time for a Sports Center right now. And the White Sox and the Tampa Bay Rays. What a day for Evan Longoria. Two home runs. The first rookie to hit two home runs in his first two postseason at bats. The Rays lead the series 1-0. SportsCenter after the game. Stay current, ESPN News.
Across the bridge in St. Pete. You mentioned the big sports day here in the Tampa St. Pete metro area. And the Lightning get underway this week over in Prague. And Melrose taking over as the Lightning head coach. Back to football on second and five. Grothy fires incomplete. He fired it hard, and A.J. Love could not come up with it. Go ahead.
That was a look defensively for Pitt right there, where they were showing what we call cover zero. There's nobody deep. And if USF can get a completion and keep it on the run, that's a chance to gash him and score.
Yeah, and I was going to say, Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, he says, when you stop putting pressure on Grothy, he hurts you. Yeah. We're coming. We're aggressive tonight. We're after them.
You need 5 yards on this third down. Keep changing it. Six on the play clock to get the snap away. Takes a shot, fires over the head of Hester. He wanted a flag, didn't get it. Pretty tight coverage by Ricky Gary. So we saw something over there, but there were two men on the Panthers secondary covering Hester.
Well, Pittsburgh so far has come in this game. They've really challenged USF and their receivers. They played a lot of bump and run man coverage. And what that allows for is these corner routes down the field, but that's a really tough ball to complete. It's got to be a perfect throw, well anticipated. And so far, Matt Grothy has not been able to hit that pass.
So here comes Micah Benani again. Previous attempt blocked a few minutes ago. This will be a career long. It's 46 yards. Only 3 seconds on the play clock. Got to snap it quickly. It's a fake. And they're not going to get it. Grant Gregory, he snapped it just before the play clock reached zero. So some special teams activity tonight. Wow. Block punt, block field goal, fake field goal.
Absolutely. Plays a part in every game. And tonight it's a real big part of this football game. But you know what? You got to be smart over there, too. This defense, they're smart. They understood exactly what the situation was.
Yeah, they kept their eyes on the holder. They're able to make a nice tackle, get the football back. Good awareness, good tackling. Because I'll tell you what, I certainly wasn't expecting that at all. I thought that was field goal for sure.
That's Grant Gregory. He's the son of Greg Gregory, the backup quarterback and defensive coordinator. Not able to make that play, and so Pittsburgh is back to work. And McCoy, who just fumbled, tries to fight for yards, and they're hard-earned.
You know, going back to,
in the stop.
Going back to that fumble we saw in the last possession, Craig, you said it exactly right. He swings that football sometimes. He had two fumbles against Iowa a few weeks ago, and that was one of the things the coaches said that he did a better job of against Syracuse this past Saturday. Good ball security, but we haven't seen it yet.
He's been meeting with the offensive line, trying to better understand their theory and strategy and blocking, and they're trying to impress upon him as coaches how important it is to run through tackles, and the big ones will happen.
You know, just take those 4 or 5 yards. Don't worry about trying to go 25 or 30 every carry. Stahl flips it out of the backfield. Collins, the fullback, sheds one tackle and gets a first down at the 39 before Carlton Williams stops him.
Really unlike the beginning of a football game right now. I think Pitt's doing a nice job in terms of play calling and keeping these downs and distances manageable. A nice short passing game so they can convert these first downs.
I'm sitting up here looking for old momentum, right?
Yeah.
And if you're the number 10 team in the country and you're playing Pitt, and Pitt, they need to take advantage of this, you know? And there's a little lull. South Florida's not dominating them.
Couldn't cash in on the turnover. They've had their problems on the field goal team. Going airborne. A nice game, McCoy.
You know what I'm saying, Jesse, though, about that? Do you feel it?
Yeah, I mean, right now, there's no real spark coming out of USF. And granted, they just had a fake field goal that got stopped. And look at this run by LeSean McCoy. Talk about sacrificing your body.
There's
like a little face mask there by outside linebacker McKenzie.
Yeah.
McCoy still in the game on second and two. Here's a nice job. He kind of cuts it back and is content to get five, Craig, right? That's what you're looking for.
No question. Make your move, get the defender off balance, and then get north and south.
You cannot hit a home run each and every running play. He's done a better job of understanding the blocking schemes, when to put his foot in the ground and get north and be satisfied with the 4 and 5 yard runs.
It's Tony Dorsett with blocking up front from Wanstead in 1973. Had a brilliant freshman year. McCoy actually had more touchdowns last season than Tony did in his freshman year.
You call that the black and white photo days.
Yeah, exactly. This is McCoy on the delay. Looked like he had to struggle to hold on to the football as he spun in the hole. It was a nice gain, and Dave Wonsett back in his offensive line days when you could be a lot lighter than 300 pounds to play, right?
He looks good today, though. Let me tell you, that back then, that guy's a wise guy.
That's not one of those guys I think you'd want to get in front of when he's pulling either.
Look at his eye there.
Look at that nose. That nose is like, you cannot hurt me.
And the nose.
Yeah. That nose, you can't mess with that.
And then Mark May came along, and that whole bunch of linemen, and just the era after Wonsett. This is Stevens howling. They spell McCoy with the 5'7 senior. No gain.
Yeah, backside George Selby, a guy that has a bruised bone just above his ankle. And, you know, they really need to look at the explosion off the ball. Now, as a tight end, AD, you got to know where the ball is going to get your head across that to cut it off.
You have to, but that's the most impressive thing about Selby, what you just said, his explosion coming off the football. And you see him here in the pregame trying to test out that bone bruise, see what his explosion's like. He looked a little iffy when this game started, but he's looking pretty good right now.
He's a guy with 22 career sacks. He's a real difference maker because he occupies so many blockers when he's in there. On third down, Stahl fires near side. It's caught by Cedric McGee. Good job to hammer him out of bounds by Tyler Roberts, a yard short. So a decision for Wonsett.
I think Wonstadt's going to go for this. If you look coming into this football game, his football team has been very good on fourth down. They're 7-for-8 heading into this game. They got real physical up front. I think this is a no-brainer if you're Pitt.
And if he didn't go for it, he would be going against what he said to his football team all weekend, that we're going to South Florida to be aggressive. We're coming after you.
He did say that. That's the mantra all week in all phases, and aggressive play calling included in that. Condridge Collins is the fullback. McCoy the tailback. Stoll's got it. He flips it short, complete to Collins. They throw it on fourth and one and convert.
You know, I said earlier that Pitt's offensive line was not selling the run for play action. Well, you watch him here. This is outstanding up front, but the offensive line selling the hardcore fake up the left side.
That shows a lot of confidence in your quarterback right here. It's fourth and one. You're calling a play action bootleg throw. Even though that's a relatively easy throw to make, they very easily could have turned around and handed that ball to LeSean McCoy.
They hand it to McCoy this time. And LeSean McCoy weaving his way into the secondary, muscling down inside the 15. Nate Allen finally there on the stop. The best run of the night for the Panthers, 19 yards.
Joe Thomas on the right side, and the right side, watch the conversion that they have here. Look at the explosion. Big 56. Look at that hole.
I think one thing we're going to have to look for here, Craig and Chris, is that there's not a lot of depth on the defensive line right now for USF or at linebacker. And when these guys can't rotate, they might start getting tired. You're going to start seeing a better push from this Pitt offensive line.
Panthers, as you saw, very efficient in the red zone this season. Hammered is McCoy, and Wilson knocked him back. They've scored every trip into the red zone, and they've had touchdowns in 10 out of 13.
But the last thing that South Florida wants to have happen is for Pitt's offensive line and that running game to get going.
Craig, when you look at this run, do you like the hesitation from LeSean McCoy right there? It looks like he's jittering. Would you like to see him just kind of hit it?
You just got to get up in there. Get on up in there.
Stahl on second and 10, fires to the corner of the end zone, and a flag comes down. There was no receiver within 25 yards. The flag is about the 2-yard line in the secondary. It's going to be against the Bulls.
Holding on the defense, number 3. Penalty be half the distance to the goal. Legal forward pass across the line of scrimmage. Automatic.
First down.
And it's Jerome Murphy, a rare recruit from the north. He comes from Elizabeth, New Jersey. Almost every other Bull is from the state of Florida.
Now, keep in mind, this is great position for the Pitt Panthers right now. They've had 13 trips in the red zone coming in. They've scored with 100% efficiency, one of only eight teams to do that this year. In the 13 trips, they've scored 10 touchdowns. They play extremely efficient when they get inside the red zone.
Penalties once again hurting the Bulls. They had four. Pittsburgh, the least penalized team in the country, not been flagged yet tonight. This is Stevens howling. Dodges a tackler in the backfield. Cannot get away. Dropped for a loss as Carlton Williams came up, and now a flag comes in. Only Burnham's defense guilty of their fifth penalty.
Dead ball. Personal foul on the defense after this is the goal. Automatic. First down.
After the tackle.
When that player, the ball carrier, goes immediately to the ground, it's horse collar.
And you know it's coming. Yep.
Samson Junis is down. Grabbed him a horse.
Oh, yeah.
In the front, huh?
That's still a horse.
All right. We ate my volcano taco. Don't look at me.
Introducing Taco Bell's new 89-cent volcano taco. With spicy lava sauce, it could be the spiciest taco ever.
Oh. Wasn't me.
Why pay more for heat when you can think outside the bun?
A work of art. A finely tuned machine. A sanctuary. A command center. A sophisticated sedan, a sports car. Together. Introducing the all-new Nissan Maxima, the four-door sports car. Lease a new 2009 Nissan Maxima for $339 a month for 39 months.
Of upsets, the title chase is wide open. What will happen next? Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines, Ohio State, Wisconsin, or Oregon, USC. Saturday at 8 Eastern. College football lives here.
Did you hear that the phone company now wants you to sign a 2-year contract for some of their TV or internet services? Contract. So if you change your mind, they can sock you with termination fees of up to $200? Nice. Hey, this is what Optimum thinks of contracts. If you don't agree our services are better, there's no penalty to disconnect. No termination fees. At Optimum, we like to keep it simple.
Thanks, Mr. Johnson!
Thanks! Albany only gives us back 10 cents.
10 cents back for every dollar we spend on our school.
You did it!
Thanks for voting 36 times.
36 times for higher taxes and fees.
$5 billion
higher.
Wow.
Mr. Johnson, thanks for voting to raise property taxes almost 47%.
Paying taxes must be fun.
Yay!
Craig Johnson, fighting for schools, raising taxes. Grow up.
Trial.
Midway second quarter, 7-7 game. The Panthers set up at first and goal at the Bulls' 5-yard line following the fifth USF penalty.
This is a very thin defensive line. A lot of injuries. George Selvey's, Genus is down now. So, you know, you're rotating guys in there that aren't necessarily your first teamers.
Fake it to Stevens. Howling stall fires for the end zone. Overthrown way over the head of T.J. Porter. And that was Selvey, who's really trying to tough it out. He's not close to 100% with that ankle, who got near Stull. And you can see he's having a hard time running on and off the field, much less getting a push, but he's still making an impact out there.
My guess is they're thinking run right now. They bring him out, they keep him in there for the passing and the pressure up the field.
Greg Marshall swings in there, number 94, to replace Selvey. Stevens Howland still in the game. John Pelosi, the tight end, motions to the fullback position as a blocker, but he can't get much room for Stevens Howling. And that was McLean filling in for Genus on the stop.
Boy, this is a critical time. Hey, Aaron, is there any kind of a vibe down there on this field? I mean, here we are in a big game, but goal line.
I have been running up and down this sideline looking from any sort of vibe, momentum. I've been running my tail off. And you know what? The crowd is finally alive. That's what's been so weird about this. It's like these people are exhausted from the Rays game. It's been weird all night.
Aaron Andrews always in pursuit of a vibe. Stowell, once again, throw to the end zone, jump ball. A flag comes down as Baldwin, the freshman, went up against Roberts. And was Baldwin beating Roberts earlier for the touchdown?
On the defense, infraction occurred in the end zone. The ball be placed at the 2-yard line, automatic. First down.
We talked about that earlier. Now, Pitt does not have a lot of speed at wide receiver, but one thing they do have is great size. And true freshman Jonathan Baldwin is 6'5", and when you get down here in the red zone close to the goal line, you got to be expecting these jump ball throws to these big targets.
Roberts knew he was beaten, just went and tried to make a play with his back to the quarterback, and now it's first and goal at the 2. It's McCoy behind Collins. LeSean McCoy cut down at the 1. It's again Jerome Murphy showing quickness off the corner.
Yeah, he is. But, you know, again, this is a Pitt football team that believes in the red zone. You just told him, Jesse, about the percentages that they have. They've got to get it in.
And if I'm Matt Cavanaugh, the offensive coordinator for Pitt right now, I'm pounding this thing down after down after down and really try to steal this momentum, play physical, and punch this thing in with my big running back, McCoy.
You got 3 tight ends in the game.
Yeah, you know what? And Nate Byam, number 80, he's a guy that you really have to pay attention to. Right side.
And a flag.
Ball start on the offense. On the 25. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
The first penalty of the night against Wanstead's team comes at a crucial spot on the field.
But he's had 2 personal fouls against South Florida that have helped him with the horse collar, the pass interference. So
you don't see many false starts in a tailback.
You don't see a lot of penalties from Pitt either. Coming into this football game, tied for first in the nation, only giving up about 2.7 penalties a game. They only had 11 penalties in total heading into tonight.
They're just looking for more room to operate down here.
That's right. Matt Cavanaugh's opening up the playbook.
Okay. McCoy. Hit in the backfield, gets away. LeSean McCoy, foot race to the end zone, touchdown. Well, Tyrone McKenzie, their best leading tackler, had a shot at him. McCoy got away and got 6.
If you're a tackler going against McCoy, watch McKenzie's legs when he lunges. He loses his legs. McCoy doesn't quit using his legs, and there's the result. Missed tackle.
LeSean McCoy is a special runner because he's one of those guys that looks like he's going to try to run you over, but he's got that speed and that wiggle to get away. I think it goes without saying, LeSean McCoy is one of these guys we're going to be seeing on Sundays. There's just no question about it.
McCoy's 6th rushing touchdown, and I saw Terrell McLean, the big tackle, limping off for USF. He was in to replace Genus, who was hurt earlier. So with Selby hobbled, depth of the defensive line, something we'll have to keep an eye on as the game unfolds. Connor Lee, again, perfect in his career. Penalties really helping out the Panthers in that marathon drive. 15 plays, 72 yards. It took almost 8 minutes, 7:54. Again, McCoy finds the end zone after some assistance from USF penalties.
Upset build week of Cinderellas and last second drama. ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Hampton Hotels. Auburn Vanderbilt, Saturday at 6 Eastern. Then at 9, number 4 Missouri battles Big 12 rival Nebraska. College football lives here.
Introducing the all-new Nissan Maxima. It has an award-winning 290 horsepower V6 engine, an intelligent CVT transmission, and a masterfully crafted interior designed around the driver. The breathtaking Nissan Maxima, the four-door sports car. Lease a new 2009 Nissan Maxima for $339 a month for 39 months.
Sometimes just getting to retirement seems impossible. That's where we come in. As one of the nation's 401k leaders, the Principal offers many simple ways to plan for retirement, making it easier for you to get where you're going. The Principal Financial Group. We'll give you an edge.
I'm not sure I want to do this anymore.
I'm done with you.
The distance, it takes its toll.
I need to go faster.
I don't know. I'm at a crossroads.
Your relationship with running has you caught in a twisted tango between love and hate. You thought about leaving it more than once. Renew your love for running. The New Balance 805 and exclusive 830 running shoes.
I guess I'm not done with you yet.
Now at Dick's Sporting Goods.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Nissan, passionate about performance and proud sponsor of the Heisman Trophy. And the Principal Financial Group. We'll give you an edge.
The Pittsburgh offense getting to flower tonight. A couple of touchdowns on the board. And LeSean McCoy, Shady, as his family and his teammates and coaches call him, capping off a 72-yard drive. But again, penalties on the Bulls, a huge part of that.
But not Shady in the negative sense.
Yeah, he says it's not because he was a shady character. His grandma gave him the nickname because he was
happy,
moody.
Sad, happy.
Eh, if you say so, Shady. I only know one definition for Shady.
That's all we cleared it up for. Everybody's playing it Shady.
Yeah. Luke Briggs, the kickoff specialist, to boot it away. And Torres Johnson lowers his head, hammered at the 17. Well, this is a familiar score. Their meeting last year at Heinz Field, it was 14-7 Panthers, and then all the mistakes began to happen, and Grothy and the Bulls made him pay, taking off on this rumbling run through the mud up there in Pittsburgh.
USF had 193 yards rushing, but this was the story right here. Three interceptions by Bostic, two of them returned for touchdowns, and this one right here by Ben Moffitt gets returned to the 1 yard line. Easily could have been three, and that was the difference in the game.
Yeah, Nate Allen had one of those interception returns for a touchdown. He's back tonight. Once again, the Bulls find themselves behind, this time at home, but that offense is just not clicking tonight, is it? They have to make another timeout.
You know what? Jim Levitt's known to be a guy who will headbutt one of his players to get their attention, to get them fired up. Jesse, he may have to break out the old headgear and go hit somebody.
A work of art, a finely tuned machine, a sanctuary, a command center, a sophisticated sedan, a sports car. Together. Introducing the all-new Nissan Maxima, the four-door sports car. Lease a new 2009 Nissan Maxima for $339 a month for 39 months.
God forbid an anthrax outbreak.
I understand why you bring this up at lunch.
You may find yourself in a beautiful house. You may ask yourself, how did I get here?
What is our exit strategy on Iraq?
There is no exit.
Based on the unbelievable true story of George W. Bush.
Yo, I can see all these lattes stiffing lefties going nuts again.
Fiasco.
And the $1 trillion mistake.
Like we owe them an explanation.
Josh Brolin is W. Rated PG-13 in theaters October 17th.
You know, scientific tests have proven that when you drink Dr. Pepper slowly, the 23 flavors taste even better. Hey, I get it, because half my life's been in slow motion. Watch this.
Okay, here we go. High ball game. He bows to the doctor. He puts the
Slower is better. Trust me. I'm a doctor.
That's the spinach, Dr. J, right there.
All right, have a safe trip, bud.
Mike, thanks, man. Wow, this is a surprise. I can't believe you're picking me up from the airport.
Who are you?
It's me, Stanley. I listen to you all the time.
Stanley, can I help you?
You can throw that in the back. Come on, we're holding up traffic. Oh, man, airport pickup, we're really taking this friendship to the next level. Yeah, it's about 10 minutes up this way, and then a right, and then another 2.5 hours.
The student section doing its part here in Tampa, but kind of a sluggish performance so far by the Bulls. The only touchdown coming on the blocked punt. The offense less than 80 yards. Incompletion. Grothy just not playing well. And this team came off a great performance, crushing NC State on the road in the rain. And I think Levitt thought his team would be ready for a big effort tonight. Not so far.
And that offense, like you mentioned, 520 yards against NC State. That's the third time this year they've surpassed that mark. And tonight, just not on the same page. They haven't had a lot of plays. You look up on the scoreboard, yeah, you got 7 points. That's from a blocked punt.
Yeah.
You've had a field goal blocked. You've had a fake field goal stopped.
20 plays, 79 yards of offense.
Yeah.
And this is a football team that really thrives as a group off of Matt Grothy and his performances.
And give Pittsburgh a lot of credit on that last drive, going over 8 minutes and keeping this offense off the football field. That's a great strategy if you're Pittsburgh offensively right now, and I don't know why you try to stop it. Keep pounding that thing on the ground.
On the ground is Greg Williams, the speedy, strong side linebacker for the Panthers, but he gets up and trots off. Didn't appear to be anything serious. That's good news. They're not exactly deep at the linebacker position.
I'm going to go back to this now. Jim Levitt's known to be a motivator. I guarantee you he's simmering right now. Levitt, he's going to come out. He's going to be the magician. Somebody's going to get it.
That's the reversal of the normal pattern. The Bulls are used to having the ball 33 minutes a game. Grothy down the middle. Again, behind the receiver, Bogan. Completely out of sync, and it sets up third and long. Reese and the gang here to say what's coming up at halftime. Reese.
All right, Chris, Mark, and Lou will be here. They'll pick the games coming up on the weekend. Most notable to those in Tampa, the rise of the Rays. We'll show you some highlights of that. And the doctor is in. An NFL owner will make a call to Dr. Lou. We'll see how the good doctor responds and what advice he has to offer. See you in just a bit.
Is it Al Davis?
Yo. Well, Lou better get extra money on that call then.
Not even Dr. Lou can solve that mess. Grothy on third and long. Flips it. Batted down. They are just getting after him. Romeus batted it away. Three and out. No yards gained for the Bulls.
One of the advantages Pittsburgh has on defense is they have a very deep defensive line unit. They can rotate guys in, play in, play out, and keep them fresh.
Did you see the push and the punch there by Romeus? He got the tackle on his heels and he used his hands and that leverage.
It's those long arms of his again.
Yeah.
He can really keep those offensive linemen off him, get his hands
again,
up.
A fresh defense.
Yep.
Alvarado into punt. Gets it away. Barry backed up at his 35. Tightropes to sidelines up near midfield. So good field position for the Panthers with about 4.5 to play before halftime as we take a look at the Applebee's weekend menu. Talk about the Auburn-Vandy game. Chris Nixon, the quarterback that we saw, has a sore shoulder, hasn't been doing much throwing in practice. Commodores have had a bye week. Auburn off back-to-back games against LSU and Tennessee.
How would you like to be Oregon going into the Coliseum after them losing last Thursday night to Oregon State? You think that Pete Carroll team's motivated to get back on track?
Well, which Oregon team shows up? The one that scores 55 or the one that goose eggs it?
They got a pretty effective offense considering all the injuries at quarterback, though, Craig.
That's what I'm saying.
First down shot. Stahl looking downfield. Fires a diving play by Cedric McGee. Didn't come up with it. Tried to salt the officials. Incomplete.
They're not going to have a ton of chances to make these plays downfield. We talked earlier, not a lot of speed for Pittsburgh at the receiver position, but they can find ways to get open downfield. Line up Cedric McGee in the slot and let him run these deep crossing routes. But that's one, again, Bill Stahl has got to complete.
Buccaneer Antonio Bryan, who was one of the great receivers in Pittsburgh history. Oh, it was close. Give it to us.
That pasture over there, you got to find a way to complete that pass.
Now they're going to stop the game and perhaps review it. Yeah, they're going to review it. It was tough from that angle because McGee's body kind of shielded the camera. The official was pretty emphatic on the far side of the field.
Well, the one thing that I did like is Stahl stepping up in the pocket and delivering the ball down the field.
So he does that ball. Yeah, it's through the hands of him. Let's see.
That'll be a quick review.
That'll be a quick review.
Yeah. You got to be pretty gutsy to try to sell that to the official. No question about that.
Let's talk about South Florida's defense right now. This is a defense that's been on the field. You just pointed out, Chris, that they were 15 plays, 8 minutes, basically the previous drive. This defense has to rally. Somebody has to step up over there and make a play
for them. Rolling on the field is confirmed. The ball now came out, hit the ground, incomplete.
Your best pass rusher, George Selvey, is banged up a little bit right now, not able to go 100%. He's not on the field right now.
You know, they've been very successful when the Panthers have been forced to run a third down play. But a better job in executing, and then Matt Kavanaugh making some nice play calls in the last couple of possessions.
Matt likes to get 3, 4, 5 yards so he can be third manageable.
And so they do run it. Good call. Stevens howling. Weaves his way, and they'll get a third and short. You know the tendency.
Absolutely. Matt's that's the way he is. Kavanaugh's one of those old-school guys. He understands. I want to get third manageable. I'm going to run the football.
And what a great job by Matt Kavanaugh. Understanding, again, the defensive ends from USF really like to push up field, and you can kind of use that momentum and run these draw plays and run right by him because it puts so much more stress on the linebackers and safeties to step up and make some tackles.
Kavanaugh, of course, the ex-quarterback of Pittsburgh. He's in the NFL. He brings kind of an NFL mentality, doesn't he? To pick up lots of motion in the offense pre-snap. And they got the manageable third and three. Then they convert. Stahl, shovel pass in traffic and brought down short of the first down as Stevens howling and a flag flies in. Keon Wilson was there for the stop. It'll be the second penalty for the Panthers. So instead of fourth and one, they'll be marched back to third and long.
Jim Leavitt is trying to decide right here if he wants to decline this penalty or not.
Holding. On the offense. Number 55. 10-yard penalty. Third down.
There's no question. You push him back. There's no question.
Because they're going for it.
Oh, absolutely. There's no question you push him back.
Wanstead's going for it. He's like, hey, I know this guy across the way is going to go for it, so I better push him back and put him in third and long.
What do you think Wanstead makes of all Leavitt's antics? We were talking to him pregame. I'm not sure he really endorses the head-butting, half-crazed mentality of
He didn't want to join him in gassers. He said, you go for it.
Wanstead might hurt his players if he started head-butting. That's a big man now.
Not when the players are wearing helmets. On third and long, Stahl winds up, fires downfield. In the traffic, there's another flag in the secondary as Baldwin was working on the veteran. He's getting the better of the senior Roberts. Another penalty on number six.
Pass interference on the defense. Number six, 15-yard penalty, automatic.
You wouldn't think, guys, that was going to be a tough matchup for USF, the true freshman against the senior corner.
But that's another great example as a quarterback of why it's not the worst thing in the world to underthrow these deep balls. Look, he underthrows it, and Tyler Roberts cannot locate the football, so he gets in the way and impedes the progress of Jonathan Baldwin. You get that free pass interference penalty. That's a good, smart underthrow by Bill Stahl.
Sometimes Tyler Roberts, being an aggressive football player, makes some mistakes up at the line of scrimmage and tries to make up for it all the time with his makeup skills. That time he couldn't do it.
You know, he's got some making up to do in this game because he's been beaten for a touchdown and flagged twice for interference, all against Baldwin. Stahl takes a shot again. They work on Roberts again in the end zone. That time McGee was the intended receiver. They're going right at number six. A lot. That time the ball hit off a shoulder pad.
We've talked about the height advantages of Pitt's receivers. Now, Stahl and these guys on offense now are starting to open up this defense because they're going to push the ball down the field some.
And if you're Matt Kavanaugh, would you not go again at Tyler Roberts right here? He's run about 100 yards in the last two snaps right now. If he doesn't come off the field,
he's out.
That's a smart substitution. Way to bounce back, though, to Tyler Roberts.
That's Matt, though, Kavanaugh. Yeah. Just understands that he's individually putting pressure on some individual out there that might not be able to handle it.
And give Roberts credit, right? That was a good play that time. Now they throw a screen. Stevens howling into the secondary. All right, Stevens howling has a first down at the 27.
Another great call by Matt Kavanaugh here, taking advantage of the USF pass rush and finding ways to beat it, this time beating it with the screen.
Did you see the number of green jerseys, that wall of green that was just getting up the field? You know, look at the line of scrimmage, and you'll see green. Watch how hard they're pushing it up the field. Great call by Kavanaugh.
That time, and we're more blockers than defenders, Craig, on the screen.
Yep. That's a good thing.
Yeah. McCoy back in on first down. He's got it. McKenzie on the stop.
You know, I like it. I know it's only a 2-3 yard gain, but LeSean McCoy was committed to getting upfield there. There was no dancing. He put his foot in the ground, Craig, and he got north.
Pittsburgh now about 2 minutes to work with at the end of this half, trying to add to the 7-point lead. Instead, thought about timeout there.
Yeah. They're just going to let it run down.
Run down.
Okay. Yeah.
Just bleed this clock.
57 yards rushing for McCoy on 13 carries. Hard-earned yards in this first half.
His magic number in this game will be about 25 carries, so they got him going pretty good right now.
We'll see how efficient the Panthers can be in the red zone. Remember, that's been an area of strength. They want to add to this 7-point lead, but not make a mistake down here. This weekend, the Chase heads to Talladega, the tri-oval to Alabama. You guys love this stuff. Go ahead, Craig. You got your notes in front of
you. You know what's really notes? What are you talking about? I'm watching. Hey, there are a lot of these 12 men out here chasing this thing that expect this to be the wild card, because if there's the big wreck that everybody's thinking could happen and it's 10 or more cars, it throws this thing in complete chaos and everybody's up for the chase. You go, notepad.
You are a true fan. You are a true fan.
Well read.
There you go.
At tri-oval, they talk about the big one. In all seriousness, that's what happens. You get that restrictor plate racing. The car's very close proximity, and you can have those big ones that can
33-degree turns.
The chase, huh?
Huh?
One of the
You've ridden
most
in a car
amazing
before?
Things I've done was driving a race car around Daytona. It's a track similar to Talladega. Second and 8. It's McCoy and Stevens Halley. Now they shift that empty backfield. Bulls rush only 4. Low pass. Nice catch by Stevens Howling, but it kind of stopped his momentum. He had to go back for the football. It'll set up short yardage situation. Clock continues to run.
It's great to have that kind of running back who can split out and play wide receiver and not just run little hitches or go routes, but actually run slants and ins and outs. He does a nice job catching the football, Stevens Howling does.
And you already have a very depleted linebacker corps that on this entire squad, they only have 4 to move around. So you put one of those inexperienced guys out there in space, it's an advantage offense.
2 tight ends in the game on 3rd and 2. McCoy. A slow developing play. He was hit in the backfield. Aaron Harris on the stop to clean it up. But excellent penetration by Williams. Clock running inside 52 seconds to go.
This is a huge stop here by Carlton Williams. You're going to see him just line up on the outside. He's just going to come in unimpeded and just make a play in the backfield. Shore up the tackle. Keep LeSean McCoy short of that first down marker.
Well, don't you see something like that, though, as an offensive coordinator, and you think, uh-oh, here's a guy pinning his ears back, not responsible backside?
Maybe a big opportunity downfield, huh?
Well, another injury to a defensive lineman for USF. That's Aaron Harris, the junior tackle. Already we've seen Genus and McLean limp out. Selvey's playing on a badly sprained ankle. You guys are going to have to dig deep in that D-line in the second half of this ballgame. Meantime, that was a real good stop. And let's see what happens here. See, check out the interior line. It was a helmet-to-helmet collision.
Oh,
right,
yeah.
Near
oh,
the tackle. Yeah, yeah, he collided with Williams, his teammate.
Oh. Well, you know, when you talk about what it means now, you've got a defense that, in my opinion, they're not into it right now. They haven't been into it this game. You're losing players. You have guys coming in playing roles that they're not used to playing. You really have to suck it up as football players.
Let's check with Aaron Andrews on the field.
And, guys, just to add what CJ was saying, every defensive player that's walked off the field tonight, they've all been shaking their heads. They're screaming, I've got 3 guys blocking me. What do we do? There's a communication issue, and the coaches are saying talk to each other out there. But I haven't seen one guy walk out without shaking his head.
They're shaking their heads because they're in new positions. They're not used to being blocked from those new angles.
Excellent kicker, Connor Lee, 7 of 8 on the season. This is from 35 yards for a 10-point lead. And let the clock run down. Wonsett doesn't want to leave the Bulls much time. And they'll call a timeout. Icing his own kicker, but get the point. Don't leave the ball. Not that this offense has done anything. They have 79 yards in the first half, but Wani's playing it by the book there, I guess.
The fact that Pitt has an offense now with 171 yards to that 79 for USF, that's pretty impressive.
You know, USF, they can't get a rhythm. They've only run 22 plays tonight. Pittsburgh almost double that number in the first half. So Grothy hasn't been sharp, but they haven't had the ball much.
No, I like this thought by Dave Wanstead, because while USF offensively hasn't been doing great, you don't want to wake the sleeping giant. They've had 22 touchdowns heading into the game. 14 of those have happened in 2 minutes and 57 seconds or less. It doesn't take this offense a lot of time to get going if they do. So I like what Dave Wanstead's doing here.
But they're used to 77 snaps kind of a game. You know, this offense just is not out there. They haven't set the pads.
So here's Connor Lee from 35. Knocks it straight through. Pretty efficient first half. Wonsett's team gives up the block punt, goes in a hole on the road, and now 17 unanswered points.
I'll ask both of you a question. All right, we've seen some good teams. Does South Florida's bench right now look like the number 10 team in the country?
No.
The guys on the field don't either, more to the point.
They just don't look it.
The environment, the environment here is strange. It's true what Aaron was saying a little bit earlier. You remember watching these guys play Kansas here at night? It was rocking last year against West Virginia at night. This place is known for being a great environment, a tough place to come in and play if you're a visiting team. And right now, it's just not a lot of energy, not a lot of juice here at Raymond James Stadium.
Totally agree, and these guys haven't really given their fans much to cheer about. Haven't had the football, and the defense is wearing down.
And truth be told, now, here's a Pitt football team that was up 14, blew a 14-point lead against Bowling Green early in the season. Oh, yeah. They feel like they should be 4-0, and many, many preseason experts felt like Pitt might be the team to beat in the Big East.
Yeah, but they also forget that they had to escape against Buffalo. Didn't wrap that game up till late in the game. 1-point win at home over Iowa. Had to escape from 11 down in the third quarter against Syracuse. They could be.
I liked Iowa's victory, though. That was I like that. That was a nice win.
This is by far their best performance, though. Let's be clear.
You're right. It was a good win against Iowa. We think they're a pretty good football team, but it wasn't very impressive still. They scored twice early in that game, and it was just kind of a sloppy win. But you're right. This is the best they've looked up to this point in the season.
So the kickoff is short, and there'll be a chance. Johnson stopped short at the 28-yard line. Yeah, I like what Wonstead said. It's like a political campaign. A major gaffe against Bowling Green got a lot of attention from the press. But if you can just recover, if you can keep going forward and tonight make a big statement, maybe the people will forget about what happened in that opening game, losing to the MAC team at home.
Now, when you only have the ball for 8.5 minutes, that puts a lot of pressure on that defense, a defense that was depleted with injuries coming into the game. Here come the boos.
There's a loss. Williams is stopped. McKillop on the tackle. 3 first downs for USF. And a total of 77 yards right now. Well, will the surprises continue on Thursday night? Are we headed for a fifth straight upset? The number 10 team in the country, they're huddling on the field before they even go to the locker room.
Yeah. He likes to do that with his football team, but you know.
There's a reason why he loses his voice at the end of every game. I don't know. A lot of theater as he yells at guys in front of the Skycam. Aaron, down to you.
Coach, what was your message there in that huddle?
Well, we just, you know, make a lot of mistakes, you know, and, you know, with penalties and those kind of things. You know, we can't get a field goal blocked, obviously. But, you know, it's a heck of a game, 60-minute ball game. We come out and play the way we can. You know, we'll have a real shot winning it. If we don't, then it's a lot like what you're seeing right now.
All right, Coach, thanks. Chris.
What he said. eight penalties and three first downs. A lot of room for improvement as the Bulls are down by 10. Surprises continue on Thursday. Back to Reese and the gang. Pontiac G6 halftime report.
All right, Chris, first half rough on Levis Larynx and also rough on their hopes to win the Big East 17-7 at the half. But the second half to come, we presume South Florida will get the ball a little bit more often. But really a dominant performance because Pittsburgh just wouldn't let Grothy get into any kind of rhythm, Lou.
Every week you have a different football team. Understand that. This is the same Pittsburgh team that got beat by Bowling Green last week, struggling against Syracuse. This is also the same South Florida team which beat Kansas but barely got by Florida International. You cannot tell. And let me tell you something else. The second half could be as completely different as the first as anything else. You just never know.
So if apples were oranges, oranges would be apples, right?
Well, don't tell me. All I know is this. I thought Pittsburgh was going to win, and you're an alum, and you did.
All I know is the Panthers were a two-touchdown underdog going into this game, and they played as well in this game as they had the entire season. You have to go back to last year when they played at Morgantown and defeated West Virginia 13-9 in that game for them to put two quarters together as well as they had in this game. They're doing it up front, running the ball. They've rushed for 67 yards in the first half against a defense that only gives up 59 yards a game. So they're getting it done, holding out of the football over 20 minutes in the first half.
Last weekend, it started on Thursday with three top 10 teams losing to unranked opponents. Halftime of our first game this weekend, and it's happening again. Still to come on the Pontiac G6 Halftime Report. We'll play a little Take Your Pick, have Lou and Mark let you know what's going to happen in the games this weekend.
The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues on ABC, Sunday at 1 Eastern. Introducing the bigger, tastier chicken strips with our new Chick-fil-A. Friday Night SmackDown debuts on My Network TV with the SmackDown All-Star Kickoff. For the first time ever on broadcast television, a Champions versus Champions night. In the main event, the WWE Champion, ECW Champion, and World Heavyweight Champion will face off in an historic triple threat match. Plus, an all-star eight-man tag match. Don't miss the SmackDown All-Star Kickoff debut.
Premieres tomorrow at 8 on My 9.
This is Robert Sims. We're talking with Sims customers about Sims.
I like my designer clothes, but at bargain prices.
Sims customers know clothing.
I bought an overcoat that probably would have been close to $200 at another store. I got it for $50 at Sims.
Sims customers know where to shop.
The prices at Sims are amazing.
Why pay three times as much if you don't have to?
The fabric, the quality, the price. So I'm in heaven.
Off price, on style. Sims.
This halftime report is powered by the G6 from Pontiac, official performance machines of the NCAA.
American League Division Series went much better for Tampa than the first half did for South Florida. Ozzie Guillen of the White Sox congratulating the Rays on their postseason appearance, and Ozzy probably not glad handing Evan Longoria. He is the youngest American League third baseman to hit a home run. Gil McDougal did it at age 23. Longoria is only 22. It's 1-0 Tampa Bay. Dwayne Wise, a three-run job, 3-1 Sox. Akinori Iwamura up with a man on, nobody out. No, Father Time catches up with us all. Back in the day, Ken Griffey Jr. might have gotten there. Not anymore. Iwamura slides in with the triple. Rays down 3-2. He would score on a sac fly. Still in the bottom of the third. Here's Longoria.
Logged down to the Gone Network.
I would like to say he's putting the long into Longoria. He's the first rookie ever to hit two home runs in his first two postseason at-bats. And Joe Maddon, with his cool glasses, had his team in good shape. 6-3. Grant Balfour strikes out Juan Uribe. Next batter. Now take a look at the first pitch, Orlando Cabrera. Now, Balfour doesn't like it much. And now we're going to restore order later in the event.
fiery, the youngsters. I think that's the singing cowboy Joe West coming out there as the umpire, if I'm not mistaken. And this time he does get Cabrera, and he's happier with it, and the Rays go up 1-0 in the series.
You know, this guy is a stud. This kid is going to be an outstanding ball player. You see this pressing on the field, you know he's going to be a great player. You know, and it's something you don't want to get beat by him, but the first two at bat, you just take advantage of that.
Honestly, I wasn't surprised. He's always in the moment. He's always got this way about him that you know he's not going to be overwhelmed by the situation. He likes these moments in a non-cocky way. He's just very confident. And so with that, I really did expect him, or I expect him to have a very good postseason.
Here's Brett Myers in the fight and strike. Now back to college football. Let's do a little take your pick, look ahead to the weekend, and let's start. One of the stories of last weekend, Alabama's win over Georgia. Now the Tide coming back home, a tough defensive squad in Kentucky coming in. Take your pick.
Well, Kentucky's very dangerous. You have to go with Florida. I just think that they're...
Or Alabama.
Alabama. I think they're very strong. In addition to that, you have to look and say, you know, they had a great win against Clemson, then they played so poorly the next week against Tulane. That won't happen this time.
I'm picking Alabama also. Coach, I don't care if Kentucky has the number one scoring defense. They've only given up 22 total points. Alabama will eclipse 22 points by halftime.
All right. There is the prediction number one. How about this one? Beanie's back. Terrell's in the lineup. Buckeyes and Badgers.
Oh, I love Terrell Pryor. You put him on the big stage, that guy produces, even though he's a freshman. You have to go with Ohio State, the revamped offensive line.
I like this Wisconsin team. P.J. Hill's been on the big stage many times in his career. I like them playing at home. And Brett Bielema's undefeated, 16 at home at Camp Randall. I'm going with the Badgers in this one.
On ESPN Saturday night, Auburn goes in, strong defense to take on Vandy.
Cinderella's going to find the golden shoe tonight at midnight, and that's because Auburn is going to play exceptionally well.
I'm picking Vandy in this game because they don't make mistakes. They wait for you to make mistakes. They have 14 turnovers on the year, 10 of those interceptions, 14 sacks. They'll find a way to win this game at home.
Former Pitt defensive coordinator doing a great job for Auburn, Paul Rhodes. Stanford and Notre Dame, the Cardinal coming in off a solid win.
Yeah, but they haven't played anybody like Notre Dame at home. I think Notre Dame, Clawson's playing outstanding. Golden's playing great at wide receiver. You have Hughes at running back.
Oh, great choice. You're picking Notre Dame. Stanford's coming off a big win. I'm picking Notre Dame in this game. Armando Allen rushed for 134 yards on 17 carries. Clawson was amazing, 275 yards, a career best. Are you kidding me? I'm picking Notre Dame. Plus, they're protecting their house. They're undefeated.
Hold the presses. I got a scoop. I will tell you, that is a first.
They're undefeated at home.
Oh, man, I tell you right now, I see the church crumbling at Notre Dame right now.
Have you guys forgotten what Harbaugh did to USC last year, giving him no chance to go in and pull? Mm-hmm. Not nearly as unlikely as beating the Trojans in the Coliseum.
Notre Dame's on a roll right now. They're playing with confidence.
All right, we'll see. He is Dr. Lou. He will answer some questions from college football and professional football dignitaries coming up momentarily. And he is the real Shady, LeSean McCoy, as Pittsburgh trying to knock off a top 10 team. Panthers on top of the Bulls, 17-7 to break.
Have work to do? You need a truck. Step up to the best. It's GMC Truck Month. Get professional-grade engineering, power, payload, and fuel efficiency, like the Sierra 1500 with better available V8 fuel economy than Toyota Tundra. It's time to go to work. It's GMC Truck Month. Now get 0% APR financing or $5,000 purchase bonus cash on the 2008 GMC Sierra. See your local Buick Pontiac GMC dealer.
I promise to play by the rules.
To play fair.
And act with integrity.
I promise to always be there for my teammates.
To be loyal and true.
I promise to respect coaches and officials.
And treat opponents with the dignity they've earned.
I promise to work hard and always do my best.
And when the game is over, I promise to shake hands, win or lose.
I promise to do the right thing and make my parents proud.
Brees and the dynamic backfield of Deuce McAllister and Reggie Bush lead the charge to New Orleans as they try to remain undefeated in the Dome. Rookie of the year Adrian Peterson of the Vikings play with desperation trying to keep pace in the NFC. It's Vikings Saints at 8:30 Eastern on ESPN's Monday Night Football.
Well, you know what they say about good advice. It's certain to be ignored, but that's not a good reason not to give it. Words to live by from Dr. Lou.
Welcome. In the Dr. Lou segment, we try to give you some advice. We try to take complex questions and make them into simple answers and leave you with a closing thought, all in the span of 2.5 minutes. Our advice is pick friends that respond well to a challenge. When you call on a thoroughbred, he'll give you all the speed and heart and desire he has. When you call on a jackass, he does nothing but squawk, kick, and rebel. That's why you don't win the Kentucky Derby with a jackass. Now let's go to our first question.
Dr. Lou, this is Gary Pinkel, the head football coach at the University of Missouri. Question I have for you is, we have two Heisman Trophy candidates at the University of Missouri this year in Jeremy Maclin and Chase Daniel. How do you think I should handle that on our football team?
First thing you ought to do is get down on your knees and count your blessings that you have two great football players. And Chase, as well as Jeremy, have to understand they need each other. And it's only natural everybody wants to win the Heisman. I wanted to win it when I played. I wanted to win it for two reasons. I've been the first player from Kent State to ever win it. I've been the first third-teamer to ever win it. And I was disappointed when I did not win. But, Gary, you understand your obligations to win championships, and you do it wonderfully. Because when you win a championship, everybody on the team benefits, including the third-teamer. Whereas a Heisman is an individual award, and only the recipient benefits. Now let's go to our next question.
Dr. Lou Holtz, this is Jerry Jones, and you know I'm a proud Razorback alumni. And I need some counseling on how to maintain my patience. You know, we have a new system at Arkansas, a new coach, and so far the results have been rough. And you know I'm a very patient man, but how do I maintain it?
Well, Jerry, the people at Arkansas are used to winning. You're used to winning. You win everywhere. But also remember this, Jerry. Your first year in the NFL, you won one game, yet you won three Super Bowls. I coached your son Steve at Arkansas. They're going to win eventually. Yes, it's difficult right now. But count your blessings. You have a great coach. You got great fans. They wear these hog hats and act like it's normal to do so. And you have great facilities. The only change I would make is I would take the defensive line and move them to offense because they've opened the biggest holes I've ever seen. And now our closing thought. You want to know the secret to getting rich? Remember this. Friendships are priceless. Time is invaluable. Health is wealth. And love is a treasure. See you next week.
Was that Bobby Petrino shuddering when Jerry Jones had, like, already? Barely gotten out of September yet. The number one alum's already unhappy.
Oh, do I want to go back to the Falcons?
Yeah. Well, let's not get carried away. Probably not. Dr. Lou, always in making house calls for you. Making a little special teams call, South Florida. Charlton Sinclair scooping it up and going, but the Bulls have struggled elsewhere. Pittsburgh's up by 10.
Morning, Mr. Bill. Here you go.
Thanks, Mr. Hans. No, wait. Oh!
Coffee. $2 on debit MasterCard.
I always wanted brown shoes.
Your personal trainer says to step it up a notch.
No, wait.
Gym membership. $59 a month.
Good. There's a bike open. What a day.
Briefcase. $120.
Wait.
Time to pack up, Mr. Bill.
Oh, no!
Making it through the day.
Hey, the bus is right on schedule.
Priceless. For whatever comes your way, there's debit MasterCard.
That's Dan, and I'm Dan's pancreatic cancer. Dan has no idea I'm here. 2 months from now, he'll see his doctor about his stomach ache. 3 months after that, he'll be dead.
I have 35,000 other people to kill this year.
Visit CurePC.org to learn how Cablevision support of the Lust Garden Foundation ensures 100% of your donation goes directly to pancreatic cancer research.
Ready to flatten those high international phone bills? Get Optimum Voice World Call. One low flat rate for all your international calls.
Talk to anyone, anytime, anywhere in the world for just $19.95 more a month. No hidden fees, no special codes, no surprises. Just like Optimum Voice, call 1-877-855-3056 and get it today. Optimum Voice World Call. Who says the world isn't flat?
This week's Pontiac game-changing performance comes from North Carolina. Miami's Robert Marv appeared to have thrown a game-winning touchdown pass when Tremaine Goddard just took it right out of the hands of Kane Farquharson, a Carolina version of the Kane Mutiny, I guess. Butch Davis beats the school he put back on the map, 28-24, $5,000 into the general scholarship fund at North Carolina, courtesy of Pontiac, for that Pontiac game-changing performance. You guys know that this is the closest vote we've ever had. Every vote counts, about 500 votes. The only difference here, and that gets to $5,000 for North Carolina. Don't forget, you can vote anytime. Log on to ESPN.com, search Pontiac, cast your vote for the Pontiac game-changing performance. Polls open Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. Eastern time after you see the nominees on College Football Final late on Saturday night. Well, perhaps some nominees coming from this game later on. Oregon State and Utah. The Mountain West 5-1 against the Pac-10 this year, and they're tied at 3 at Rice-Eccles Stadium. Important game for perception for both leagues, Mark.
It definitely is. I'm waiting for Jacquizz Rodgers to tune it up and start getting a few more carries because he had that huge game against USC.
3-3 game, getting late in the first quarter in Salt Lake.
This halftime report is powered by the G6 from Pontiac, official performance machines of the NCAA.
Search Pontiac G8 reviews online and see why it's getting a bit of a reputation. The Pontiac G8 GT, the most powerful sedan for the money. Now use your purchase bonus cash and get a G8 sedan starting at $26,595. Offer ends November 3rd. See your Buick Pontiac GMC dealer today.
Believe.
Believe in yourself.
Trust your instincts.
Believe in work ethic.
Think.
Believe in loyalty.
And compassion.
Believe in integrity.
Embrace diversity.
Believe in discipline.
Fear no challenge.
Believe in dreams.
Be passionate.
Persevere.
Believe in collaboration.
Believe you can make a difference.
This telecast is available in high definition. Brought to you by Pioneer's new Kuro.
Go downfield, throws it up, and running under the ball is Jonathan Baldwin for a touchdown. Good boy. Hit in the backfield, gets away. LaShawn McCoy, foot race to the end zone, touchdown. USF, ranked number 10, down 10 at halftime. A very listless performance by this group in front of their home crowd as Pittsburgh comes in here, plays very well, and jumps on the Bulls, who had the ball less than 9 minutes, eight penalties, hard time on the third down, had a field goal blocked, couldn't convert a fake field goal, got the one touchdown from a blocked punt, but Grothy didn't have the ball much and couldn't get any rhythm at all.
No, he didn't. If you're, you know, Dave Wannstedt, we'll take the other side of the field for a moment. I would be over there with those young football players, and I would be telling that team, fellas, you're young, don't be fooled here. You're on the road against the number 10 team in the country. They could wake up, and they got a quarterback capable of getting them back in it.
Remember, USF's already proven that. They were down 17 points to Kansas. They were able to bring them back. This USF team has proven in the past. They play very well in the third quarter, but I think give a lot of credit to Matt Kavanaugh, the offensive coordinator at Pitt. He's done a real nice job dialing plays up, keeping Matt Grothy and some of those playmakers on USF's offense off the field.
Stahl was able to get his offense going with a long touchdown pass. Grothy will get the football first, and USF, you know, some urgency here. Their defense is wearing down. Lots of injuries on the defensive line in that first half. Guys are gimpy. They were on the field a long time. And there's Selby. He's been gutting it out on a bad ankle, but I think that even though it's, you know, start of the third quarter, important for the Bulls to get something going, Craig.
Maybe offensively. Growth that goes to the line of scrimmage, and they go up-tempo. You've got to wake up the football team.
Riggs to kick it off. And this is Bogut. Montavia Bogan stops short at the 25-yard line. Our Home Depot coaching adjustments.
Well, Jesse and I talked about this here. What do you do here at halftime? Let's go to Pitt. Pitt, keep the football because you want to play keep away from Matt Grothy. Run the football, LeSean McCoy. Get him up inside and outside and mix it up.
They're doing a very nice job at taking advantage of the pressure from USF. They're throwing little screen passes. You see here, they're running draws. And they've been very smart on when to take chances down the football field. And Bill Stahl was able to make them pay. Throwing the football deep.
Grothy, only 22 yards rushing, 36 yards passing. That's it. Jamar Taylor is the setback. This is Taurus Johnson on the reverse. The senior runs smack into three defenders over there. Austin Ransom, again, new at this position. Looks like he was born to play linebacker.
Well, he's born to run, that's for sure. 86, Ransom was a wide receiver. You see him on the inside, the middle. There he is right here. Watch how 86 is able to get to the outside.
Austin Ransom's a great story. Was a walk-on, played receiver. He was a strong safety in the spring and was the most active player on defense for Phil Bennett. And he was able to move him over to that outside linebacker position. He's done a nice job playing there.
Empty backfield. Pressured, Grothy gets away, dumps it off. It's complete. Good coverage there and a short gain. Cedric Hill, the tight end, run out of bounds as we check with Aaron Andrews.
Chris had a chance to catch up with Pitt head coach Dave Wannstedt. He loved defensive line pressure that they put on Matt Grothy and, of course, the way they controlled the clock. He said the only way we're going to win this game is if we keep Matt Grothy off the field. Hey, guys, in an update from USF's locker room, on a scale of 1 to 10 intensity level, I heard through the grapevine, Jim Levitt was a 15, no headbutting, no count there, no tally.
Gather the team on the sidelines in front of the camera and try to get his team going immediately. And Grothy on third down near the marker, Mick Williams on the stop. And that was a crucial scramble by the quarterback.
And up the middle of the field. And I think Matt Grothy recognizes that he's got to put this football team on his shoulders, doesn't he?
He does, and that's big right there. Converting a third down right out of the gate here in the second half. Find ways to get this momentum back on your side.
He was brilliant against the Jayhawks in that rally here last month. 15 of 19, 204 in the second half. This is Plancher. Waits for his blocker. Lowers the head for four. That was a terrific back and forth game. You know, Kansas rallying late after they'd been behind, and finally the field goal by Benani to win it with 0-0 on the clock.
And Todd Reesing is a heck of a quarterback, right? You know, a guy very efficient. It was a great challenge, great character game for South Florida.
And Matt Grothy, he went toe-to-toe with Todd Reesing the entirety of that football game.
They're toe-to-toe. I like Grothy. He's also a black belt in karate over old Todd.
Wow, yeah. We shouldn't have given him such a hard time about his bad hair, dude, the other day.
No Plancher again. I'll try to work it to the junior. Looking for a hot-handed tailback. They've been tough yards from that position. It'll be third and short.
All right, Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, has done a great job of dialing up the pressure at the right time. He has to keep the pedal to the metal.
Yeah, he acknowledged that when teams stopped blitzing Grothy, as Kansas did in the second half, then he kind of was able to make plays. He was very forceful about that. Keep the aggression going no matter what the situation is in the game. On third and short. Hard fought yards for Plancher. He gets a second consecutive first down. Berry on the stop.
Really like this play calling coming out of the gate from Greg Gregory, offensive coordinator. We saw a lot of pass plays. They were trying to move the pocket a lot in that first half. And here they come out in the second half. They're keeping it conservative on the ground, trying to, chew clock. Nice job so far, though.
Look at this. Four receivers to the top of the formation. Empty backfield for Grothy. Instead of throwing left, he comes back right. Lobs it down to Love, who makes the catch. And A.J. Love runs under the football, 38 yards.
Yeah, you know what? This, you said it, Chris. You've got four receivers to the left. Really nice job of Greg Gregory setting up his one-on-one with a taller receiver.
And Matt Grothy realizing it. And just a beautiful ball. Just throws it up and over the outside shoulder of A.J. Love, able to go underneath it and catch it.
Giovanni Chappelle was there on the coverage. Now they're going to review this. Looked like Love made the catch and got his feet in bounds, or one of them anyway. Was he juggling the ball? That'd be the question they'll look at with the replay.
Or did he have, yeah.
Yeah, I think he had.
He had possession. I think that's a possession. Catch.
It's close though. Yeah. You can see why they're reviewing it.
It didn't look to me like this was even a question when we saw it live. But you see him try to cradle it. He kind of pins it off his thigh right there, doesn't he?
You know, what's your definition there?
Is possession of the football? I think this is a catch.
You could pin it on your leg like that.
Yeah, I think this is a catch.
Yeah, it's not conclusive enough to overturn, is it?
Yeah. Either way, I think it's a great job again. The offensive coordinator, Greg Gregory, running the football. Boom, you take a shot.
And that's Love. He's come on as a receiver. He beat out Carlton Mitchell, who was the starter a year ago. Sophomore from Bradenton. Nearby, Tampa.
Southeast High School. That's a powerhouse program down here in Florida.
And he has worked hard to overcome Carlton Mitchell, the fastest guy in the Big East, big 400-meter sprint guy, and just a hard worker, probably their best receiver.
That's saying a lot, too, because this is a very deep group at USF.
It's a very big review as well. Did they keep the 37-yard gain? Are they set up at the 16-yard line? Or is it backed up near midfield?
You know, there is the longer it goes, the more you think that they're wondering, did he have possession? Was that ball sliding down and he didn't have total control? They're going to rule it on the field
as well. Review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. The receiver had possession of the ball with 1 foot in bounds, first down and 10 for South Florida.
So the first big pass play for USF stands. Right back to work, same formation, four receivers to the left. Love at the bottom of the screen.
We got the one-on-one down here at the bottom of the screen again.
Again against Chappelle.
Press man-to-man coverage. This is a good opportunity to strike again.
This time, fakes the throw to the left and takes off running. Matt Grothy knocked out at the five. So that formation giving the Panthers trouble.
Well, you know what it does here. You opened up. Greg Gregory again opening up a quarterback designed run. He knows he's going to have that single pressed up deal on the right side just like he had the previous play. And it opens up a soft corner, really soft corner to the right side of your screen.
You know, it's funny. Greg Gregory says that he would take Matt Grothy over any quarterback in college football right now. What a statement that is considering what Matt Grothy's asked to do here in this offense.
It's Plancher on first and goal. So they had three first downs in the entire first half, four on this drive already.
Yeah. Hand off to number three.
Whatever Levitt said or whoever he had butted or didn't had butted, it's worked with this offense that looks so out of sync in the first half.
Number eight's come out. The first down, the third down run that he had on the quarterback draw on the other end of the field, barely gets the first down, then the big throw.
The good things we're having for this offense is usually because of number eight.
Yeah.
Second and goal. They have single coverage on Love again. Bottom of the formation. McGrothy fakes the run. Little jump pass in traffic. And a flag comes down as the official hits the deck. They look for Hill, the tight end. Shades of a Tebow kind of jump pass, Jesse, but you shouldn't throw it if it's that crowded, huh?
Holding on the defense. Number 86. Half the distance to the goal. Automatic.
He got ransom. He got away with the Grothy there.
I love the play call here. You know, you run the quarterback draw a couple times. That sucks these linebackers up at the line of scrimmage. And you got a big target in Cedric Hill, but you're right. You get down close. You got to be careful where you're putting that thing.
And big 225-pound Mike Ford in the game. Ford has it. Hit in the backfield. Muscles forward. No signal. He stops short.
Boy, this is where having a running quarterback like Matt Grothy really puts pressure on a defense. You suck up in there, you got to stop the dive back. And you have to stay bit disciplined on the outside, Jesse, or else he'll pull the ball and he's gone on the boot.
This is big right now for this offensive line from USF. They have four seniors on this O-line. They really need to establish themselves here in the second half.
You know, the ball kind of got near the plane right there, didn't it?
Yeah.
And I don't think he was down. Ford still in the game. On third and goal, Grothy keeps it, powers forward. Touchdown. First touchdown for the Bulls offense tonight. Very impressive looking drive to start the third quarter.
Whatever Jim Levitt said to this football team at halftime, it worked. That could not have been a more impressive drive offensively coming out of the gate.
Benani tries to cut it to a three-point lead. Almost as many yards in that drive as they had in the entire first half. Matt Grothy looking for some love. AJ Love, this big pass setting up the touchdown run.
Well, it might surprise a lot of people that ExxonMobil would be interested in lithium-ion battery technology applied to hybrid electric vehicles. Our new battery separator film is a true breakthrough that's going to enable the deployment of more hybrid vehicles faster. This means a tremendous reduction in greenhouse gases, the equivalent of removing millions of cars from the road. I think this is the most important project that I've worked on in my career.
My new computer started out fast, really fast, but now it's only kind of fast.
Hold on, let me check my email. It's not loading. Let me try this again.
If your PC doesn't run like it's supposed to, if your internet connection is unreliable, even on a so-called fast connection, even if your brand new computer isn't as fast as it ought to be, you might not have any real problem at all. FinallyFast.com free performance test will immediately diagnose any hidden problems and show you how to get more speed on any computer. Plus, FinallyFast.com provides you the software you need to get your computer up to peak performance by getting rid of all the nasty junk files, spyware, adware, and registry errors that make even the best computers freeze and crash. Find out why Ascentive has been featured in Newsweek, Forbes, and the Wall Street Journal. You could save hundreds, even thousands of dollars by taking the FinallyFast performance test first.
I'm booted up. That URL I should look at. FinallyFast.com. Hey, my computer's fast. Finally. FinallyFast.com.
Signing up for digital phone service through your cable provider? Do you really think bundling with your cable company is saving you money? You've been bundling. It's time for Vonage.
When you bundle, that low promotional rate expires and your bill goes up. With Vonage, your rate starts low and stays low. Sign up now with Vonage and get 1 month free. Enjoy clear digital phone sound quality using your high-speed internet connection. Get Vonage, the number one rated digital phone service.
Call 1-877-4-VONAGE or go online today.
Monday, harbinger of the Monday morning meeting. This is a meeting about meetings. It summarizes last week's meetings and discusses the meetings on the radar for the upcoming week. It's when the boss tells his duck joke.
It's a duck.
So you go, because you need the brownie points too. But with Monday comes Monday Night Football on ESPN, where Peterson and the Vikings take on Bush and the Saints. So just remember, they're not the boss of you, at least not on Monday nights.
Now some juice in the house here. ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Applebee's, the student section.
Oh.
Having fun. Not somebody's daughter, fellas. He may be watching tonight. But you can see that just an ineffective first half, and they got to go on an 11-play drive there. Grothy kept it going with that scramble, finished it off with the run, but the big pass to Love was the key. Stevens Howling. Trying to find some room, cuts it back. Nice little return out to the 30-yard line. And let's check with Aaron Andrews. Aaron Grothy got dinged in that drive.
He did. On his left hand, on his thumb, kind of the padded area of his thumb, it looked like he broke open a blister. They taped it up pretty good. He's got blood all over his towel, actually. Keeps looking at that thumb. The trainers have been hustling to bring out something. I'm kind of curious. I don't know. Jesse could probably fill in what it is, if it's going to be a glove or something. But, guys, also for the defense, I was told that all the guys that were injured in the first half, they're fine to come back here in the second half.
That is good news. And we're getting banged up in that D-line in the first half. They fake it to McCoy. Stall a first down throw on the sidelines, and it's complete to a Derek Turner.
Does that answer your question as to whether or not Pitt is going to stove up, shell up?
Now, I was wondering if they'd be conservative now. The other offense is going, playing with the lead on the road.
And how do they respond? But isn't it great to have running the football, working in your favor in that first half, to come out the first play of the second half, to throw a bootleg and a big comeback down the sideline?
And in regards to Aaron's report, it'll be interesting to see. Even though Selby and those guys are back in there, can they handle another 30 minutes?
They got a wrinkle here. Stall, the quarterback's in the slot. Oh, and a bad snap. Collected by McCoy, but a huge loss. Well, they tried the Wildcat, but it blew up, and Selby was there for the huge tackle for loss.
Pitt coaches went to Arkansas, and they talked to the Arkansas staff about the old McFadden Wildcat formation. Jesse, I don't think they talked about the snap.
What do you do when it's over your head? A good job of McCoy just getting on the football again. Here's George Selby, who's supposed to be ailing coming into this game. No problem with the speed getting all over McCoy. There's the yin and the yang. Big completion on the first play, and you have a snap over McCoy's head on the second.
Yeah, anything but conservative, Craig, but an 18-yard loss puts him in deep trouble here on second down. Still into traffic, almost intercepted. Danny Verpeo was in the neighborhood, so was McKenzie, as they converged and buy on the tight end.
Yeah, you know what? Here comes the screen, something, you know, conservative. They don't want to make a mistake on this end of the field, obviously. And the South Florida defense did show back up on the defensive line.
Yeah, they sure did. They're pinning their ears back right now. You almost feel this momentum creeping back over again. And just listen to the crowd.
Crowd's in it.
What do you got on third and 28?
Punt.
Avoid the turnover, huh?
Yep.
Stull throws it over the middle. The tight end Bion has it. And that's a nice gain, but he'll be 4 yards short. Allen on the stop.
That is so big for Pitt right there. No, they don't convert to get the first down, but field position wise, that is huge. They have a chance now to pin USF deep back in their own territory.
But I would say, if you're USF, though, you're saying, hey, job well done. Wally Burnham's defense went out there and they held when they needed to hold.
Well, with a big assist on the bad snap to McCoy as they tried to wrinkle and it backfires. Dave Brightus has had an adventure. Should have had his first punt blocked. They missed it. Did have the second punt blocked. And now it's a fake. He throws it. Incomplete. A flag came down. They tried to get it to Convridge Hollins. A nightmare on the punt team. They had him, and he short-armed it.
Short-armed it. He shot-putted it.
And it's going to be USF ball. They'll decline the penalty.
It wouldn't have mattered anyway with that false start penalty. That would have been coming back, but boy, oh boy, what a chance.
At least they'd have had a chance to reload, though, because if the kid, Brightus, throws the football.
Wow.
They complete that, it's a first down.
They must have seen something. So punt nightmares for the Panthers. That is the last pass he'll throw. USF will take over.
For the price of lunch in a bag, how about a real lunch instead? With people and silverware and lots of choice. Applebee's Pick and Pair Lunch Combos, starting at just $5.99. Over 75 combinations of soups, salads, sandwiches, and pasta. From grilled shrimp and spinach salad to three cheese chicken penne. Try finding lunch like that at a drive-thru. Applebee's Pick and Pair Lunch Combos, starting at $5.99. It's the best meal and the best deal in the neighborhood.
I'm comfortable in jeans that are tough. I'm comfortable. and Wrangler. Real comfortable.
Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans. Satisfaction guaranteed. Wrangler. Real comfortable jeans.
I can't see.
Tomorrow, see for yourself the controversial new film that critics are calling bold, thought-provoking. This you do not want to miss.
Oh, my God.
Blindness, rated R, starts everywhere tomorrow.
I don't know. Maybe you should have been the blonde.
Maybe you should just listen to the game.
Maybe if you shaved your legs like me, the sneak-in would have worked.
Maybe if you hadn't lost our season tickets in a lawsuit because you got cheapo insurance, we'd be inside the stadium, watching the game, dressed like men. Huh?
I don't want to get into this she said thing.
Getting cut-rate insurance to save a little money could end up costing a lot. Call an Allstate agent today for a free Good Hands coverage checkup. Are you in good hands?
Sirs, your comments on global warming.
It's definitely hot. Just like the NFC North's running game.
It's a pass-happy league, but this division likes to keep it on the ground.
When you've got Adrian Peterson and Ryan Grant, why not?
Does that help?
Tune into the best team in football. Sunday NFL Countdown presented by IBM, Sundays at 11.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Allstate, proud sponsor of college football and the 75th Allstate Sugar Bowl. Are you in good hands? And ESPN Game Plan. Saturday, catch Florida State, Miami, and Florida, Arkansas.
Bulls are finally cooking here in the second half. The Panthers have the lead. Bulls have the ball and momentum following the miscue on the fake punt. Take over in plus territory at the 48. Mo Plancher and Ben Williams flanking Brothy here on first down. They give it to Williams, and Ben Williams hammers ahead. I'm going to be tactful here because Rytus, we talked about the mixed martial art fighter, the black belt in karate. I'll be careful what I say here, but they did not teach him to pass in the dojo. He's got all that Anki. He's a transfer from Purdue, but I don't know, Craig. You can criticize Wonsett for defying conventional wisdom, but he did say pregame he was going to be aggressive, whatever the score was, and he's done that.
I don't have a problem with it. I think, you know, he called a play that should have been executed and could have been a first down.
Brothy going downfield. Incomplete. Good coverage there. Carlton Mitchell kind of gave the DB a shove, but could not make the catch. As we check in with Reese Davis, an update on the Utes and the Beavers that we saw a week ago.
Now they're underway, Chris, and Oregon State comes up with a play on defense. Brian Johnson's pass right into the gut of Al Afalava. The pick six, missed extra point. Couple of Sakota field goals for the 15th-ranked Utes, but the Beavs up by three in the second quarter.
Thanks, Reese. We wondered how the Beavers would respond to the big win over USC going on the road against a good Utah team. We'll keep you posted on that game. On third and nine, Grothy is hit and dropped. McKillop got him on the blitz. That tough senior linebacker came storming through. Already nine tackles tonight. That's the biggest, though.
Nice job, Phil Bennett, defensive coordinator, coming with the pressure. Jesse, don't you, though, as a quarterback, have to know that McKillop is going to be coming? These linebackers are coming hard in the middle in situations like this.
You know, this defensive coordinator, Bennett, does such a good job getting pressure, whether it's maximum or getting one-on-one matchups. Scott McKillop comes through untouched to force the USF punt.
You got to pay attention to all punts tonight. Everything's happening on the punt team for both teams. Alvarado gets it away. Barry, fair catch at the 15. So just a boring old punt. Nothing happened there. And the Panthers dodge one. We'll go back on offense up by three.
Stand by.
All right. Who ate my volcano taco?
Don't look at me.
Introducing Taco Bell's new 89-cent volcano taco. With spicy lava sauce, it could be the spiciest taco ever.
Oh. It was me.
Why pay more for heat when you can think outside the bun?
We'll be right back.
another wild week of upsets, the title chase is wide open. What will happen next? Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines, Ohio State, Wisconsin, or Oregon, USC. Saturday at 8 Eastern, college football lives here.
Hey, Jill, are you coming to book club tonight?
Are you screening your calls? Where are you guys?
Get more out of life with the Optimum Rewards Card. Enjoy free movie Tuesdays at Clearview Cinemas, access to pre-sale tickets, shopping discounts.
Mom! Dad?
Even the chance to win once-in-a-lifetime experiences. If you've got all three Optimum services, go to OptimumRewards.com and sign up for your free rewards card now.
Thanks, Mr. Johnson!
Thanks! Albany only gives us back 10 cents.
10 cents back for every dollar we spend on our school.
You did it!
Thanks for voting 36 times.
36 times for higher taxes and fees.
$5
billion higher.
Wow!
Mr. Johnson, thanks for voting to raise property taxes almost 47%.
Paying taxes must be fun.
Yay!
Craig Johnson, fighting for schools, raising taxes. Grow up.
College game day coming to you from Vanderbilt. Auburn and Vandy at 6 o'clock Eastern time, followed by Missouri and Nebraska. We wanted to do game day from that pirate ship here at Raymond James a year ago when they were number two. If they'd beaten Rutgers, you know, Cincinnati was coming in here. It was going to be a huge game, and upsets happened and our plans changed. What do you think? Game day from the ship over there?
Rutgers
took the water underneath your ship out of there.
LeSean McCoy spins away. First down. So McCoy, he's had some tough plays tonight. You know, he fumbled the ball earlier. He was part of that missed snap. But some positive plays as well. 26 yards there.
You know, I think the coaches were wondering about LeSean McCoy coming in this game. If he would revert back to what he was doing the first couple of weeks, trying to hit home runs every play. But Craig, on this run, he just puts his foot in the ground again and gets upfield.
Well, you know what? Once you get beyond the line of scrimmage, it's okay to shake and bake. You've gotten your 5 yards. Now you can start using your open field running ability. That was a very nice move.
The catcher, that was a flag at the end of that play. Nate Allen forced him out. So make it a 41-yard gain. Yeah, the penalty in there. Once again, Levitt's team, serious problems, self-destruction in the flag department.
It's right here. It's these guys on that defensive line. Those guys there are beat up, banged up, trying to make it through a game.
McCoy will test him again. Doing a nice job on the right end. That's one of those guys who's beat up and banged up. Selby, better known as a pass rusher. Here's the late hit.
Right there, LeSean McCoy's out of bounds. If you're Nate Allen, you got to let that go. That's a bad penalty.
And that's frustration, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, again, in the big scheme of things, we're talking about the number 10 team in the country, USF, at home against Pitt. And this team has not played up to the top 10 ranking.
Second and 10, tight end in motion. They fake it to McCoy. Stell steps up. Now he's hit. Fumbles the ball. It's loose. Picked up by South Florida. Keon Wilson scooped up the fumble. Stell was blindsided. Robinson forced it. Momentum swings back to the home team.
One thing Bill Stahl told us heading into the game was he had to have a very good clock in his head in terms of when to get rid of the football. And Craig, on this play, that clock ran a little bit too long.
It did. It ran too long. He looked good early on, stepping up. Now get rid of the football. Now, I was telling you, they didn't look like a top 10 team. How about Jarrett Bowie stepping up and making a play like a top 10 defense is supposed to make?
So once again, South Florida takes over in Pittsburgh territory. They got nothing out of the last possession following the fake punt attempt. Plancher and Williams in the game. This is Plancher. Great defense. They string it out. Gotten for a loss. It's Ransom, that speedy linebacker with the long hair at the back of the helmet.
The guy at Pittsburgh Steelers, former USC guy.
Polamalu.
There you go. He's got that same kind of play going. Troy Polamalu.
I wouldn't put him in Troy's category as a player just yet.
Not yet. Got the hair, though.
Ransom comes out of the game on second and 12. Empty backfield. Once again, it's McKillop showing pressure up the middle. He's right over the nose of the center, number 40. And he's coming. Brothy dropped again. And this time it's Duncan. This is what Wonsett wanted. Get a lead, turn the pass rushers loose. They haven't been able to do that in recent games.
This is one of the best teams in the country at getting pressure. They're averaging about 3.2 sacks a game. That's tied for seventh in the nation. When you can keep guys fresh and you can mix guys in, look at the push they get from both outsides and then the stunts inside by Greg Romas.
Third and 20. Short connection here. Torres Johnson gets back to midfield, but for the second straight possession, the Bulls start with phenomenal field position plus territory. Can't do a thing.
That Pitt defense stepping up big now. They've gotten some big sacks here on these last two drives, Craig.
Their defensive line is the most talented they have on their unit, and they're deep. They're too deep, and they're fresh, and they're moving. They're fast, just like that, getting back to the receiver.
And that's the advantage right now that USF does not have, and we'll see if that hurts them as this half goes on.
They're inspired. So you got three Florida guys who start that defensive line for Pittsburgh, so it's a homecoming game for them, and that's a factor. Bulls get a nice bounce, and they'll down the punt. And that's Quentin Washington, who's been so active. He's the guy that blocked the punt earlier. That time he gets down there, and he'll pin the Panthers inside the five. Another chance for Mr. James to talk about the chase going to Talladega.
You know
what? Some more notes for
him. I'll tell you what, 188 very intense laps, speedways, massive 2.66-mile quad oval.
Who's leading the chase right now?
Well, right now, you know, I had Carl Edwards, and he's been bumped out by Jimmy Johnson. Greg Biffle's been hot. I'm still sticking with Edwards.
And Jesse, Mr. Formula One over there has nothing to add on the NASCAR boys down there in Talladega.
I'm waiting for the question. I'm just waiting for it over there.
You in Talladega. I'm not feeling that.
Maybe Ricky Bobby.
Ricky Bobby.
This is McCoy takes a handoff in his end zone. Nice little juke. He got past Murphy. McKenzie was there. So critical possession, the Panthers must avoid, and there's some trash being talked now between these teams.
I was going to say, one more thing I think we got to take note of here. George Selby, a lot of credit right now. He's playing hurt. He's been playing a lot of plays, and he's making an impact, too. He's really sucking it up. He's out here trying to inspire this defense, trying to make plays.
Hasn't had a sack yet, but you're right. He's been active out there, and he occupies blockers when he's in. Stoll, sideline, has a man. Nice catch there by Oderic Turner. And he's got a first down. Caught it in front of Murphy. 9-yard game.
You know, sometimes you see Stoll make the play like that right there. The execution of stepping up, and he had protection.
I was just going to say, it really helps as a quarterback. When you can take a 5-7-step drop and sit there, got a great vision to throw the football. Nobody's in your face. Makes it way easier on you when you're a quarterback and you got that kind of time.
Okay, on first down, gets nothing. You know, Stoll's a guy who's a perfectionist, and he's very hard on himself, and his coaches have tried to get him to lighten up and just be able to bounce back from a mistake, but he learned from Tyler Palko, who's his predecessor here, a very intense guy. He's learned a little bit.
Yeah, he doesn't get down on himself when he makes physical mistakes or bad throws. It's when he makes mental errors. That's when he tends to get a little bit embarrassed, and that's something that offensive coordinator Matt Kavanaugh would like to see him stop doing.
He made a mental error in not getting rid of the football on that sack and fumble, but he's shaking it off here. Final minute of the third quarter. Takes a shot downfield. Lobs it up. Way, way underthrown. Cedric McGee was locked up with Tyler Roberts, who's had a rough night, but Stoll didn't come close to it, making that throw.
That's an example of Matt Kavanaugh. You saw the H-back tight end in motion there. That ensured that he had his single coverage up top and gave him a chance at the home run ball.
It's funny, Matt Kavanaugh told us that in order for Bill Stoll to complete some deep passes, a lot of things have to go right. He tends to throw the ball better deep down the middle of the field. He struggles on the perimeter. He's been great throwing the ball deep on the perimeter in the first half. That last throw got away from him.
Ugly.
Yeah.
Pressure. Shovel pass. McCoy. Darting around LeSean McCoy. Fighting for a first down. What a play by the sophomore.
Wow, what a great effort.
Got that in heavy traffic.
Hold on a second. I have to stretch my groin. I'm up here moving.
That was impressive.
And I'll tell you what, there was almost a clip block, and I don't know who the Pitt player was, but Jesse, he held off because, you know, this is a ping pong ball going through there.
It's a great setup again by Matt Cavanaugh. They've used the draw. They've used the screen. Now you see the shovel pass, finding ways to get LeSean McCoy into the second level of the defense, and you see the moves. You see why he's considered one of the best young running backs in the country.
He seemed to have a great sense of where he needed to get with that marker, didn't he? This is Stevens howling. Flag flies after a one-yard gain. McKenzie on the stop. Some guys, even in traffic, just have, in the middle of the field, just have a feel, right, for
it's
where that
sense.
First down is?
You can't premeditate that move. It just happens. And he's got that, and that's really why he suffers sometimes at the line of scrimmage of dancing too often.
Check the flag again. The Panthers' least penalized team in the nation coming
There's
in.
There's no flag on the play. Second down.
They'll pick it up. They have three penalties tonight, Pittsburgh. That's right at their average per game in the first part of this season.
Now McCoy's doing his deal. Stevens Howling has to pick up the slack now and give him a spell and have some success.
15 minutes to play. USF down by three on their home field, trying to protect the perfect record. And that number 10 ranking in Pittsburgh, trying to make it five straight upsets on Thursday nights.
ESPN.com/results simulator.
Now that's what I call good strategy.
The kids have been wanting to go to the Safari theme park since last summer. So we used our City Cash Returns card to buy the tickets and stuff.
So cool.
It was great to get close to the animals. But not that close. Luckily, we used the cash we got back to help pay for some body work.
With your City Cash Returns card, earn unlimited cash back and get it mailed to you automatically. Whatever your story is, your City Cash Returns card can help you write it. Because City never sleeps.
Sealing your bathroom can be a disaster. Your fingers were never meant to be used like this. Just look at the mess. You need ProConk, the only tool that delivers a neat finish in just minutes, again and again. Apply silicone as usual. Select your sealing edge, then slide along for a perfect finish. Reuse the excess silicone like this and extend the seal without showing the joint. Look again. There's no wasted silicone. Amazing. Select a smaller edge for a thinner silicone finish. ProCaulk is perfect for kitchen countertops to seal edges and eliminate those leaking corners. Sealing a corner neatly was impossible, but now with ProCaulk, you can do it like a professional in seconds. Any edge, any corner, any joint, ProCaulk gives you a perfect finish in minutes. Made from Duraflex, the ProCaulk set is guaranteed to last year after year. Best of all, there's 8 sealing edges for every application. You get a 16-millimeter corner to ensure a smooth finish, a curved edge to fill in the gaps between flat surfaces, and a grouting tip for between those tiles, and 5 more spectacular edges. The amazing ProCaulk Toolkit is just $19.95. We promise it will give you a clean, straight finish in just minutes, again and again, or your money back. But if you order now through this special TV offer, as a bonus, you'll get a third applicator for hard-to-reach places. You'll also get a silicone remover to remove and strip old grouting. Plus, you'll get this tube of silicone. Call now and receive the complete ProCaulk kit. 3 tools with 12 edges. Silicone remover tool, a tube of silicone for only $19.95, plus shipping and handling. Any edge, any corner, any joint. Your solution is ProCaulk. Call now.
To order your ProCaulk, call 1-800-539-9145 or send check or money order for $19.95 plus shipping and handling too. ProCaulk, 2 Morgan Avenue, Norwalk, Connecticut, 06851. Call 1-800-539-9145. That's 1-800-539-9145. Call now.
Monday, harbinger of the Monday morning meeting. This is a meeting about meetings. It summarizes last week's meetings and discusses the meetings on the radar for the upcoming week. It's when the boss tells his duck joke.
It's a duck.
So you go, because you need the brownie points too. But with Monday comes Monday Night Football on ESPN, where Peterson and the Vikings take on Bush and the Saints. So just remember, they're not the boss of you, at least not on Monday nights.
Final 15 minutes in a crucial game in the Big East race. USF, with the nation watching, trying to show they deserve that number 10 ranking. Dave Wonsapp just once has surrendered a lead after three quarters. Not known for their comebacks when they're down after three, but 15-1 when leading after three. And not a good start to the fourth quarter on 2nd and 9.
Ball start on the offense. Number 34. 5-yard penalty. 2nd down.
It's the second time they've called a tailback for a false start tonight for Pittsburgh.
You know what? And this really is fourth quarter. You do have a young football team on the road, number 10 team in the country. This is where guys have to step up and play beyond their years.
And Chris, going back to what you said earlier, this team's now 15-1 under Wonstead after the third. Can they go 16-1 if they continue to play aggressively like Dave Wonstead said they wanted to?
Stone fires to Stephen Hallen. He makes the catch, again, follows his blockers. Good run in traffic, a first down out near the 40. Thought there might have been a false start in the right tackle, but they didn't catch it.
Yeah, he just got there quick. He was right on snap with it. We all three thought it could have been. How about Matt Kavanaugh? How about the calls that he makes, the timeliness of these calls for the screens, and then the backs finding the holes?
Well, how about the different types of screens, though? This might be the fourth different type of screen we've seen in this football game. And again, Matt Kavanaugh taking advantage of the pass rush, getting the football to his running backs in space.
Stevens Howling. Not much there. That's one way to counteract an aggressive pass rush, huh? Dump it off on screens.
Yeah, and I got to give a shout out to Conrad Collins, number 30, the fullback at Pitt. His dad's Tony Collins, who I played with in New England. TC's doing well, I hear. Hello, TC. Hope you're watching. Man, he's bigger than his dad.
I know, he's not quite as fast, though, is he?
Oh, his dad had some shake and bake.
Once again, the Panthers offense behind schedule. They get just 1 yard on first down. McGee comes in motion. Stoll fires out in the flat. There's Tony Collins' son, and he says, I got a hand just like my dad. And it's a first down across midfield.
He's a ham like his dad. Gets a little of attention and shows off.
It's a nice job by Bill Stoller. These can sometimes be the hardest throws to make for right-handed quarterbacks. These flat routes to the same side, and puts it right on the hands of his fullback, Conrich Collins. Nice throw, Bill Stoller, continuing to move the chains here on this drive for Pitt.
Hard throw and a hard catch.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we've seen this with the clock rules. You can really chew some clock when you get the lead in the fourth quarter. It just seems to go away quickly. There's a flag as they hand it off on the reverse. Doran Dickerson, a stiff arm out of bounds down near the 30. Nate Allen forced him out. Now we'll check the flag. It's a 16-yard gain if it stands.
Offsides.
Offsides. Offside. On the defense. Number three. Penalties declined. First down.
Now the tight ends in this offense aren't your typical kind of bruising guys. Dickerson's 230. Not a big-time blocker, but he runs well.
Good position kind of guy, though. And you know what, Jesse, we talked about earlier in the first half about the overcommitment of South Florida's defense, losing containment backside. That took advantage of it.
It's a little bit of a clinic right now for Matt Kavanaugh, isn't it, on how to kind of counter a team that's very aggressive in pursuit.
Wow.
Aggressive drive by Pittsburgh, trying to build on a three-point lead. And Stevens Howling darts forward for about five. Reese has another update on the Utes and the Beavers. Reese?
Actually, a couple of them, Chris. Utah's sort of gone off in the passing game. Remember, Brian Johnson threw the pick six earlier. Buys a little time and finds Freddie Brown from 26 yards out. He was by himself. Third touchdown catch of the year. Now running a little option. Brent Castile's going to dive for the pylon. They had another look at it. Touchdown Utes. It's 20-9 just before halftime.
All right, thank you. Now the 15th-ranked team faring better than the 10th-ranked team tonight. Another flag. Guys getting a little anxious in this fourth quarter.
Yeah, they are. You wonder if Oregon State's out of gas,
offside,
though.
Offside. On the defense. Number 91. Right. Five-yard penalty. Second down. Yeah,
that's kind of the Beavers' second. If they make a big play, they'll blow a coverage. It's all over the place.
And the Mountain West Conference just owning the Pac-10 right now, with the exception of Cal beating Colorado State, really.
Yep. 5-1 the Mountain West.
The Pac-10 needs Oregon State to play big in this game.
I'll tell you who needs Oregon State to play well in this game is USC, so that if USC runs the table and humps it towards the end, that they got a chance to have respect for the title.
You always get your eye in the big picture, Craig. Utah needs it because they're a BCS Buster contender on a collision course with BYU. And they got the
November 22nd.
At home.
November 22nd, that's a big one. Yeah, both teams could be undefeated heading into that game.
You're making a funny noise.
I don't agree with that. They're not BCS Busters. Go play in the Southeastern Conference somewhere. You can get it on every week.
To be continued.
In today's luxury game, the question isn't whether or not your car has available features like a 40-gig hard drive. It isn't about sunroofs or Sapelli wood accents, pop-up nav screens, or any of that. No, the real question is, when you turn your car on, does it return the favor?
Hello again, everybody, and welcome back to the much-anticipated matchup between the Eagles and the Bulldogs. Hold on. I'm not quite sure what we're seeing right now, but cows are parachuting onto the field. I cannot believe what I'm watching. Two cows landing on the field. There's a third headed into the stands. It's actually headed right towards a burger. Look out! Oh, my. That's going on the highlight reel.
Work so crazy right now. Fashion Week's coming up, and I have to meet with all these LA designers to line up clothes for the show. It's so crazy.
Oh, yeah.
What? What?
Reflect your style. Get the new Ultra Sleek LG Shine. It's this season's hottest accessory, designed to move you fashion forward. Get our exclusive LG Shine for only $49.99 and get one free, only from AT&T.
Favorite team home with Glidden Team Colors Paint. The true colors of true fans. Team Colors Paint, exclusively from Glidden and only at the Home Depot.
This is Detective Tyler, and he back.
In the blink of an eye, Detective Sam Tyler's whole world rewound back to 1973.
I've been in a rage.
And he has no idea why.
This is my desk, my computer,
like 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Harvey Keitel, Michael Imperioli, Gretchen Maul, and Jason O'Mara.
Do we have a warrant?
Here's your warrant.
Perfect.
ABC's Life on Mars. The series premiere next Thursday, 10, 9 central on ABC.
ESPNU Allstate mock BCS standings. The real ones will be out soon, but this is using the same two polls, the Harris and the coaches and the computers here. Remember on Saturday, a lot of these teams on the road. Got to be careful with these road games. BYU plays tomorrow night at Utah State. They should win that game.
Can I draw with you for a moment? This one over here, too, that team right
careful,
there.
Yeah.
Careful.
Upside alert for the Crimson Tide.
Just hello, darling.
Kentucky can play some defense, and we'll talk more about the unfolding big picture as the Panthers try to convert the second and two. Stoll steps up. Still got it. Throws to the end zone. Over the hands of Cedric McGee. They took a shot, still being aggressive. So you made a little noise. You don't have a real strong belief, Craig, in the BCS Busters from conferences like the Mountain West. You got BYU and Utah. You saw the Cougars there. Utes not yet in the mock top 10, but they will be if they keep winning.
I've been consistent. You and I have worked together a long time. I've always believed Utah's a good football team. Don't get me wrong, but I always say this. The teams in the SEC and the Big 12 this year are being challenged week in and week out. Ole Miss beat Florida.
We're not talking about the championship game. We're talking about just playing in, you know, the fifth BCS bowl game that was kind of created to give a non-BCS conference a chance. You're begrudging them that?
No, but you alluded to the fact that they're beating a team that just beat the number one team in the country. Did he not, Jesse?
No, but I'm saying, you know, you don't think BYU and Utah are good enough
good
to
teams.
Get the, B, or the BCS at large? You know, at large.
Oh yeah. I'm talking about national championship.
Oh, no, I didn't mean that.
Okay, good. Glad you clarified that for us here.
Well, I think everybody will always go back and look at Boise State beating Oklahoma and say that a team is...
It can be done.
It can be done.
On first down now, McCoy. Short gain as Pittsburgh continues to try to chew clock inside of 11 minutes to go. And this drive already has taken almost 6.5 minutes.
Yeah, 13 plays, 70-something yards. You know, this is a grind. Hey, Aaron.
I'll say championship game next time. Just so you won't be confused. A BCS bowl game versus championship.
I'm all right with the BCS.
Okay.
Yes, yes. Hey, EA, are those guys on South Florida's bench getting depressed or disgusted or discouraged?
Oh, there's no talking. Everybody's putting their heads down. You know, the more and more their defense gets penalized, they just get upset. Are you guys done fighting up there, by the way?
No, not yet. Stahl fires, sidelines incomplete. It was off the fingertips of Dickerson. We're discussing.
Yeah,
fighting.
It's an issue. It's a conversation. Jesse, how do you like it?
I understand why the team will be down, because it's been frustrating for everybody involved in USF to see the defense with this many penalties, but they got to stop here. Field goal attempt, you're still down just 6.
Yeah, I get the feeling watching this game, though, that Pitt came into this game and they have a bit more of an understanding of what this game means to them. Wouldn't you guys agree?
Yeah, and on this play here, again, Matt Kavanaugh's idea, get close, fourth down, we might go for it.
Greg Selby digs in for the pass rush on 3rd and 8. It's the draw to McCoy, and this time he cannot dance his way to the marker. Tyrone McKenzie with the stop. And on comes the field goal team.
Great call. Make this thing so that they cannot kick a field goal and tie it. Make this thing 6 points. I can't get it out of that. I wanted to say make it a two-possession game. But I thought, hey, wait a minute. 6 points is still a one-possession game.
Chris, wasn't he the guy that told us that one time? What was the deal, 10 out of 10? Or what?
After a guy missed making a play, said he'll make it 10 out of 10 times.
Yeah, and you had to correct him, maybe you mean 10 out of 11.
Were we in Colorado? Was that a high altitude?
Here's Connor Lee from 31 yards. Very, very reliable senior kicker. Makes it 9 of 10 on the season so far, but the deficit is just 6, and Matt Grothy and the Bulls go back to work, 9:40 to play.
H3T, the most versatile Hummer ever.
Sirs, your comments on global warming.
It's definitely hot. Just like the NFC North's running game.
It's a pass-happy league, but this division likes to keep it on the ground.
When you've got Adrian Peterson and Ryan Grant, why not?
Does that help?
Tune into the best team in football, Sunday NFL Countdown, presented by IBM, Sundays at 11.
Wait up! Hold the bus! Hold the bus! Hold the bus! Woo! Hold the bus!
That was close.
Sorry, guys. One hand to a bus.
Well, that's a bad beat.
This is Robert Sims. We're talking with Sims customers about Sims.
I like my designer clothes, but at bargain prices.
Sims customers know clothing.
I bought an overcoat that probably would have been close to $200 at another store. I got it for $50 at Sims.
Sims customers know where to shop.
The prices at Sims are amazing.
Why pay three times as much if you don't have to?
The fabric, the quality, the price. So I'm in heaven.
Off price, on style. Sims.
E
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood. And in part by Hummer, like nothing else.
That's where Jesse's headed after the game. Yes. That little Latin dancing.
Embarrassing for me.
Oh, look, Evan Longoria there of the Rays there, and he's the hero from this afternoon. A couple of home runs, stole a base.
He better get that straightened out. It'll be 0-4 tomorrow.
This is the guy we're talking about right here, okay? That's where you should be focused.
I'm telling you, that's an 0-4 day tomorrow.
Wow.
Just a little distraction.
It's the big leagues. You can, you know. Fun, go out. He's over the White Sox this afternoon. They misplay the kickoff. Bogan. Fortunate to get back to the 15-yard line. Some miscommunication as the special team misadventures continue for the Bulls. And we check in with Reese Davis for SportsCenter right now.
Game two of the Phillies and Brewers series. Chris, right there. Shane Victorino, a grand slam off CC Sabathia. He didn't make it out of the fourth. Philly leads the series 2-0 after the 5-2 win. Plenty of highlights and reaction on SportsCenter after the game. Stay current on ESPN News.
All right, Reese, thank you. See if the Cubs can get on track. It's the Dodgers. This is Mike Ford. Mike Ford follows his blocker and picks up about 10. So the Bulls, a crucial drive here, able to force the field goal, still down by only 6. But the way the Panthers have been chewing clock, you just don't know how many more possessions you're going to get in this game.
Yeah, you know, these long drives put a lot of pressure. But again, we've got a fresh defensive line at Pitt. They've been rotating. And McKillop in the middle.
Meanwhile, the Bulls go up tempo. Quickly to the line, hand off to Ford. Big guy shimmies and shakes across the 30. So poor field position after the misplayed kickoff, but Ford in 2 carries has him out across the 30 already.
USF has to stay up tempo right now. They got to find a way to just keep running plays, get some more offense going in this game. Averaging 464 yards of offense heading into this game. They're only at 161 right now. You got to run more plays to move the football down the field.
They have 42 snaps compared to 65 for Pitt.
Way, way, way under their average. This is Ford. Nice run, Mike Ford. He's starting to come alive now in the fourth quarter. The sophomore who led the team in rushing as a true freshman, showing why he was so highly recruited out of high school.
Well, here's where youth really hurts you on defense. Watch in the lane assignments at Pitt how they get bunched up and overrun their lane assignments, and there's the cutback.
On their last scoring drive, we saw Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator from USF, start the drive this way also. Run the football, suck defenders up into that box so that Matt Grothy can take shots down the field throwing it.
Well, it's coming.
And McKillop was kind of sitting there waiting for him to come to him instead of going after him. And Mr. Ford took a left turn. Ford's a guy who comes from this area, played a high school all-star game on this field, and highly touted again. Originally committed to Alabama. Some academic issues, ended up here, and he's been a big boost to this program. 3 straight 9-yard runs.
He's, you know, 220, what, 225,
yeah,
maybe?
Yeah, wow. 225, 6'2".
Big guy. I wonder who's going to get the ball here.
He's still in the game on 2nd and 1. Ford. Hammering ahead with a 45. It's all Mike Ford on this drive.
You're starting to see that senior offensive line really assert themselves here on this football drive, getting a great push again, Craig, against a fresh defensive line from Pitt.
And I, you know, you kind of broached on the thought, but this run creates the play action. And again, that youthful Pitt defense better pay attention.
41 yards for Ford, and he's 4 carries up in the drive, and he's got it again. They just keep feeding him. This time, only a 2-yard gain. There he is on the stop. Now, you don't have a chance when you rotate backs as much as the Bulls do to really get in a rhythm typically, Craig. But I think by the fourth quarter, isn't it good to have a guy
lathered up?
Yeah,
absolutely. And especially when he's 225 pounds and starts leaning on the inside.
Ford to the right of Grothy on second and eight. They fake it to him. Quarterback keeper. Grothy makes a man miss, gets down the sidelines. That was old Austin Ransom as a flag comes in late. Austin Ransom, that speedy backer, Grothy made him look silly there, huh?
Jesse, did you ever make a move like that?
not on purpose. I ever did not on purpose.
That's unbelievable. Matt Grothy in the quicks.
Gave him the dead leg, didn't he?
There's no flag on the play. Play ran out of bounds. First down.
Again, the flag is picked up. An 11-yard run. He's deceptive, I'll say.
And it wasn't a defensive lineman that he shook. That's Austin Ransom, a former wide receiver, and just gave him that dead leg.
You do the hokey pokey, put your left leg in, you put it like.
I'll be enough singing. Big guy, Ford, breaking tackles. Ford barreling down near the 20. And this defense for Pittsburgh, which was so stout in the first half, held the Bulls to 79 yards, appears to really be wearing down now.
Time for Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator at Pitt, to dial up at a minimum a run blitz. He's got to keep the pressure. They've been playing safe. They can't do it any longer.
And USF just keeping it simple right now on offense. Not dialing anything crazy up or fancy in the pass game, just pounding it straight ahead.
Ford wrapped up for a loss. That time, Jabal Sheard came off the corner.
This is also a point of the game, too. Ford's had five or six carries in a row. He's probably a little fatigued. I mean, all backs get there.
He's coming out of the game now.
Yep.
Edmund very active all night. But suddenly, 53 yards, almost eight a carry on this drive. Mo Plancher spells him on second and 12. It's Grothy looking to throw. Cuts back, fires. To the end zone. Touchdown! Jesse Hester Jr. Run, run, run. Set up the pass. First pass attempt of the drive. The touchdown to Hester, his third touchdown of the season. Mike and Benani for the crucial extra point. Nothing's been easy in the kicking game tonight, but Benani knocks it through, and now Wanstead's team so good at protecting leads in the fourth quarter. Finds itself down by a point.
At least not on Monday nights.
Bulls on parade here in Tampa, Florida. Touchdown catch by Jesse Hester Jr. Set of push-ups on the field. Set of push-ups in the stands there. Hester got free against Eric Thatcher. That was a matchup Pittsburgh defensive coaches were worried about. Eric Thatcher's a senior, a solid guy, but against a slot receiver as tough as Hester. Not a good matchup, and now the kickoff just goes down and rolls out of bounds. Bizarre problems on the special teams, and Pittsburgh will take over on the 40. Just needing a field goal to take the lead.
Got to play effective in all of the areas. When we go back and look here at this touchdown, first of all, Phil Bennett knows that anytime you don't put pressure on Matt Grothy, he hurts you. They don't. Here's Pitt's defense going back, and they're not really doing anything with it.
And what a throw by Matt Grothy here. This is just a broken play. He's got duress. He's got somebody on his legs. He could not have thrown that football more perfectly to Jesse Hester.
Wally Burnham said, the key in my mind is to put the ball game in the hands of Stahl at the end of it, and he's trying to win the game. I like my chances if I can get him to that.
Exactly, and that's where it is right now. They do have some time. They have the time to still run the ball on this drive. 5:57, 60 yards from the end zone. Stahl's going to still be aggressive. Fires on first down. Has a man wide open. Splitting the secondary is Derek Turner down to the 22. They're living up to what they said. Being aggressive,
and old Coach Burnham not expecting that kind of play. Boy, you're talking about settle down in the secondary, find the pocket, find the hole, and Stahl steps up and drills it.
It looks like the cornerback here, Tyler Roberts, gets lost a little bit. He just trails and gives Oderic Turner too much space on the in route, and that was maybe the most confident throw we've seen from Bill Stahl tonight.
This is McCoy. Cuts it back. LeSean McCoy. Run out inside the five.
All right, Coach Burnham, careful what you hope for here. You put it in his hands, he hits you with it. Now, you talk about shake and bake at the line of scrimmage. We've seen it now four or five times tonight where McCoy has made some outstanding open space moves.
Do you think Tyler Roberts was afraid of LeSean McCoy right there, afraid to commit to that tackle,
you
Chris?
You think old Tyler's had a tough night?
Oh.
Burn for the touchdown, couple of pass interference. May have lost his man Turner in coverage a second ago.
Now you missed the tackle.
There's going to be nights like that in football, I guess. But
I guess.
He's having one of them. First and goal. It's McCoy in the I formation, gets the toss, cuts it back, touchdown. What an answer from Pittsburgh.
It feels like USF and Jesse Hester just scored a play ago, doesn't it?
Well, three plays ago they did.
Yeah, they did, absolutely.
Three plays ago they did, and that just tells you right there, that USF defense wasn't ready for the task to come back out and answer it.
He goes 60 yards in three plays. Second touchdown from McCoy.
Here's your foot, Jesse. Here's your foot now. Put your foot in the ground and get north.
See the cut, understand the scheme.
How about my man Collins, Conridge. Great block, Collins.
Playing like Craig Hayward.
Two here, guys. They're going to up five. And old Wally Burnham, he felt good if he had the lead and still had the ball, but that wouldn't have worked out. But still time for Grothy, 4:43.
Yep.
Will this be a five-point game or a seven-point game? And they're going to use a timeout on defense. They had three. They'll spend one here on defense before this two-point play. This is big. If Pittsburgh can score, it becomes a seven-point game, and the Bulls will think overtime instead of trying to win it with a touchdown. We'll check back with Reese while we've got a second here. Reese.
All right, Chris, this week's AT&T ESPN All-America Player of the Week, John Parker Wilson from Alabama, 13 of 16, 205 yards and a touchdown in the Crimson Tide's victory over Georgia. You can vote every week. All you have to do is text VOTE to 51234 on your AT&T wireless phone, access the nominees, and enter for a chance to win a trip to the national championship game in January.
Thanks. We saw JP play so efficiently behind the big offensive line. My guy, Anton Caldwell, the center for Alabama, made it pretty easy for John Parker down there in Athens.
Well, they did. There are a lot of players. You know, the thing that impressed me the most was the tenacity that they had in that game. You were there on the sidelines, but they just looked like Alabama came.
You see Grothy. He's going to get the football back. Will he be down five or down seven? They've got...
It looks like man-to-man coverage. I wouldn't be surprised to throw a jump ball to one of their big receivers here.
Well, you can't throw a jump ball if you're going to drop the ball. Stahl just falls on it. He made a big pass in that drive. They don't get the two-point conversion. And Grothy will take over down five.
Yeah, you know what? You just, like Dave Wan said, are you kidding me? Not that there was anything there. I mean, we don't know if it was open or not, but...
At least he fell on it, didn't allow the Bulls to pick it up and run it back for two the other way.
Well, in the background there, you saw Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, and they're already trying to figure out exactly what they need to do here. I would not sit back. I think you've seen, if you sit back, you're going to get the ball run down your throat, or Grothy's going to hurt you with a big shot.
Well, both defenses kind of worn out at the end of this game. Offense is having their way.
That's where all of that hype that we heard all week about that two-deep defensive line comes into play right now.
It's got to show up right now, absolutely. If there's one defensive line in this game that is able to step up right now because allegedly they're more fresh, we got to see it right now.
And EA, Buddy Wallace, a strength coach, it means a lot to this Pitt team.
Absolutely. CJ, you're the one that brought it up, actually, when they played Iowa. The guys said the defensive line got stronger as the game went on, and just talking to the coaching staff about him, they were saying the younger guys have benefited the most from this strength coach. He is tough on them, and Dave Wonstadt loves it.
Breaks to kick it off. He keeps it in bounds, which is good news. Nice kickoff. Drives Bogan back near the hole. Bogan breaking tackles. Had to be brought down at the 35. 33 yards on the return. Primetime, Ohio State and Wisconsin as the Badgers try to bounce back from blowing the 19-point lead in Madtown. Most of you will see that game when the West Coast will get the Ducks and the Trojans in the Coliseum. 8 o'clock Eastern on ABC.
I spoke with Brett Bielema this afternoon, you know, and his dad gave him great wisdom. He said, son, you stubbed your toe, you didn't break your neck. Stay the course, focus on your football team.
Brophy fires near side. Makes a Love connection to A.J. Love, who gets it out across the 40. McKillop there on the tackle. They get six.
How about Greg Gregory changing it up? He started the last series running the football.
Yeah, getting it out early now, getting into the hands of his playmakers on the perimeter, trying to show this Pitt defense something new.
All the defensive coordinators had that concerned look on their face at this point in the game. It's Ford. He is whacked hard. Wow, big hit there by Rashad Duncan. After a short gain, it'll set up third and three.
But that just shows you the experience of Greg Gregory. You know, and thinking about it, feeling the game, knowing it, where he was, and comes back and gives him something different.
What do you call here on third and three? A running quarterback. You got lots of options if you're
remember,
Gregory.
They're not good on running third and short. They're better passing.
It's man-to-man again.
He tried to pass. Now he's chased. Grothy throws the ball away. They'll throw the flag for the obvious grounding. He was pressured. Three Panthers right on him.
Potential grounding on the offense. Number 8. Loss of down. Fourth down.
Yeah, that's a crucial, crucial penalty. USF has a couple of timeouts. And they'll send out the punt team. Great pressure again.
Craig, you see here the pressure of the fresh D-line, but look at all the pressure coming from the second level as well. Phil Bennett doing a great job dialing up different pressure.
Well, Duncan got there. McKillop was there. DeSico also in the blitz. Big stand by the Panthers on third and three, and they'll get the football back. Fair catch by Barry. Pittsburgh back on offense inside 3.5. You've seen both defensive lines make some crucial plays tonight rushing the passer. Just when you thought Pittsburgh's defense was wearing down, the nice call, they brought the house against Grothy on third and three.
Well, you know what? In the last drive that Pitt had offensively, it was quick, it was brief, it was three plays. But McCoy, they somehow at South Florida have got to find a way to bottle him up before he breaks loose.
You know, and Phil Bennett talked about this coming in the game. There's different ways you can pressure Matt Grothy. You can send one guy at a time and try to get a mismatch versus someone blocking, or you can send the house, and they did it right there.
This is Stevens howling, not McCoy in the game, and he'll lose yardage. And they'll stop the clock with a timeout.
Like that, because you know, otherwise you let the clock bleed down and it's 40 seconds off of it, and then you get pressed up against the wall. Too many coaches let the clock bleed down and they don't have timeouts, and then it just eats them up.
Another reminder about games on Saturday. Paterno and the Lions hit the road to Purdue. Always tricky when you go on the road for your first challenge away from home here. Noon Eastern time on ESPN. Following game day.
We talk about this team every week, guys.
Fun to watch that offense, huh?
How good do you guys really think Penn State is? I'm a believer. I think they're the real deal.
Well, and you know, Chris alludes to it. It's a road game for them. Purdue's not a bad football team. But the fact that Evan Royster and that offense and they Clark and their execution, they score.
They're not a good defense, Purdue. If you saw the Notre Dame game, they're last in the league. If Clark executes, that's a big...
So you're saying Notre Dame doesn't have a good offense?
Not as good as Penn State.
Okay.
I'm saying Purdue's defense is struggling.
All right,
let's see here. On second and 11, it is McCoy back in the game. He's got it. Some big bodies in front of him, but they shoot the gap. That was McKenzie flying in to make the tackle. It'll be third and about nine.
That is a top 10 football team making a play defensively. They had to suck it up and get from the inside out to stop McCoy because they had that set up for a nice game.
It took right tackle Joe Thomas a long time to get outside to seal that block, and LeSean McCoy was on his heels quickly, and that USF defense able to just really swallow that whole play up.
You throw it and take a chance of it hitting the ground?
I don't know.
What if you're aggressive? Dave Wanstead said it.
Now they fake the throw, hand it off to McCoy. McCoy makes a man miss. Heads for the sidelines, gets out of bounds, but gets the first down.
How many times tonight have we seen LeSean McCoy take it upon himself in third and long and convert these huge first downs?
And well, you can get a pass for going out of bounds when you get a first down like this. Now I want to watch the defensive guy waits on McCoy to get there. You cannot wait. Here he is on the outside. You got to go get him. You've got to go get him. Cannot let him dance.
It was Jerome Murphy. Couldn't corral the running back there. And now, with just one timeout remaining, it's going to be tough for the Bulls. The clock running again inside of 2:15. McCoy buys the other corner. Picks up about four. The bail on the stop. Level will have to use his final timeout here.
Well, and again, South Florida blew a timeout on the two-point conversion down here just a little while ago, right? They'd love to have that in their pocket right now.
Watching this USF defense right now, it looks as though they're afraid to tackle LeSean McCoy. They're not sure what he's going to do. Is he going to try to run them over or run outside of him? And LeSean McCoy all night tonight has done an excellent job of staying the course, trusting in the scheme, putting his foot in the ground, seeing his cuts, and getting north, Craig.
And you know what? It came out in this game plan here. Pitt's plan was to run the football to see if South Florida could stop them. They've been able to do that tonight. And the space, the open space, the foot in the ground, the cuts, the power, the rush chart, it's clear. This is a strong game. Four carries for 28 yards to the left side, but look at the middle of the field, huh? That's called the heart of the defense.
It's been a different LeSean McCoy we've seen now the last 2 weeks. From the Syracuse game on Saturday to today, just trusting in the scheme, not trying to hit home runs each and every time he carries the football. He's looked a lot better today and against Syracuse.
Yeah, that was his first 100-yard game of the season against the Orange. He had 149. It's not always easy for a running back to come back on a short week after a 100-yard game and do it again. He's got that second straight 100-yard game now, .132 tonight. McCoy still in the game. And he's got it again. Bouncing it. Fighting forward. It'll be third and about three. Bulls cannot stop the clock, so if they can get this first down, pick up 3 yards, Wanstead is going to go home with a big, big road victory to make Pittsburgh relevant again.
He's got a very good coaching staff. Matt Cavanaugh at offensive court. There's Tony Wise right there. Used to be with the Dallas Cowboys with Dave. Tony's been around a long time. This is one of the best offensive coaches, line coaches in America.
Let's see if his guys can create enough room for McCoy. Third and three ball game here for the Bulls defense. Flag before the play. A false start's going to make it tougher now.
False start on the offense from the 56. 5-yard penalty.
Now you talk to your guy up as an offensive line coach, and this guy goes out there and makes a false start.
It's just inevitable. Look at Tony.
Oh, man.
He'd tell me, Craig, don't ever say anything good about my offensive line. You jinxed him.
And we'll see what they do on third and eight. Again, USF can't stop the clock, so you just hand it off, wind it down, punt it, play defense.
Yeah.
That's the call. McCoy just protecting that football, wrapped up at the 47. Grothy gets the hat on, gets ready, but he will not have much time.
Well, here's a punt formation now. We've seen USF get after this thing twice. They've had a block. They've had a near block. You incorporate the Florida Gators spread punt formation this year. Man, oh, man, I bet there's a lot of people's hearts pounding right now on that Pitt sideline.
I tell you what the punter's been told to do. Catch it and punt it. We'll put the clock on him. Get Blackie up here with the stopwatch going. He better be in the 1-8 category, Blackie.
Now, let's see now. Play clock at 8. Brightus had his troubles here. Looks like they're just going to call timeout. Not hurry things. Get the protection all settled. And you see that the Bulls, needing a touchdown, going to have to go a long way. Won't have much time. You're right. Spending that timeout when they had to, defending the two-point conversion proves big. Difference that they had one more timeout. They'd have a whole lot more time to work
probably
with
a minute.
Offense.
Probably at least a minute. At least a minute. But, you know, when you look at this game and for South Florida, they're going to go back, and you have to realize this was a football team that came in here. They were beat up on the defensive line. They were thin at linebackers. They only had four guys on their unit. They played a valiant game, but Dave Wannstedt, you could sense that he felt like, dude, we're coming in here and we got you.
I just feel like they understood kind of the significance of this football game. We talked earlier. They had that bad loss week one to Bowling Green. A lot of people wrote him off, but they have a chance to right the course right now, get back on track, and pull this win out.
You see Stahl there showing some leadership, trying to get the guys up off the bench, get them near the sidelines. Crucial punt. 10 men on the line for the Bulls. They come after it. Redis gets it away. Hogan spun around, wrapped up at the 28-yard line. 1.9 seconds, says Mike Black, our spotter.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mike. That's called get rid of the football. 2.0 or better, and you're in good shape. 1.9, you know you got a chance.
What was your get-off when you played at SMU?
I went to two-step punting, and it really helped me a lot. And 2.0 or better is what everybody goes for. It eliminated a lot of over-kicking.
And Grothy needs a miracle now. No timeouts, 22 seconds. 72 yards away, rolls out. He's pressured by a three-man rush. Grothy gets away, skips out with 16 seconds. Trying to get close enough, I guess, to reach the end zone with a Hail Mary. He's not the strongest arm throwing the ball downfield.
Yeah, absolutely. But you know what? Here's a guy that can buy time. Relax. You're out of bounds. Relax. Take a moment here. Don't push it, but you got to get to midfield.
If your defense for Pitt, keep everything in front of you.
A rush three. Grothy taking a lot of time. Fires downfield. It's a catch made across midfield. They'll stop the clock momentarily. Bogan got it. 8 seconds, but they move the chains. The clock will run.
You got to spike this football right now. Clock it.
The clock starts. They do spike it. And they got 6 seconds to take a shot at the end zone.
Hey, they gave themselves a chance, didn't they, Jesse? They got the ball to midfield. They got a chance to get the ball down the field.
Let me ask you this. Do you guys think Matt Grothy can reach the end zone from here?
It's a stretch, really.
That's a long throw. We're going to be looking at probably a 60 to 55-yard throw here.
He has been compared to old Flutie Flakes Doug many times. If he pulled this off, Flutie Flakes will send him a box.
Here it is. Game's final play. Grothy winds up, heaves it from his own 47 to the goal line. Incomplete. Ball game over. Another Thursday night upset. Hugs all around for Wannstedt. They stumbled badly in the opener at home to Bowling Green. This, he said, could maybe make up for it and stall in that offense. Trailing for the big march down the field. A satisfying win for Pittsburgh. First loss for the Bulls. Let's go to Aaron with the winning coach. Yeah.
Chris, thanks. Well, Matt Grothy, for the past 2 years, has actually burned you guys on some pretty big plays. What was your mindset with that last one right there?
Well, he's a great player, and the debate was, do we give him time to throw it or try to pressure him? Our defensive line did a great job the whole game of pressuring him, so we stayed in the four-man rush. Offense made some plays. I mean, defense, it was a great win. You know, it's these guys got a real good football team. We needed this so bad for our program to give us a chance to take a step. I'm so happy for these kids and these coaches. They did a great job.
Everybody had been asking us how big this win was for you personally.
Forget about me. This is about Pitt. Thank you.
All right, Chris, there
well,
you go.
Yeah, but he's been on the hot seat. There have been a lot of critics, and they came after him in his program after losing to Bowling Green in the opener. But now Pittsburgh, 4-1. They're 2-0 in the Big East. They're in first place in the conference.
It's interesting. You know, they come in tonight. They get a big win over a ranked opponent. Look at LeSean McCoy and his numbers, what he put up.
Yeah, the old Wrangler player of their game there. Not a bad game for McCoy.
Yeah, second 300-yard game.
You know what, though? This and what it means to Dave Wannstedt and his coaching staff is that they can continue to build on what they're doing. They have young football players that came through when they had to come through tonight. And on Thursday night, where a lot of recruits are watching, it helps them.
Remember, Vanderbilt goes down. Rutgers goes down. West Virginia goes down. USC goes down.
Where are we at next week, Chief?
Oh, upsets happen on Thursday night, the fifth straight. Pittsburgh comes down to Tampa, hands the Bulls their first defeat. Another ranked team goes down. SportsCenter's up next. ESPN News Postgame Extra, a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Craig, Jesse, and Aaron, and our entire team in Tampa, I'm Chris Fowler. So long for now.
Is SportsCenter.
You'll see that CC is human after all, how the Phils got to the Brewers ace early, and a rookie steals the show by making history in the Rays playoff debut. Alabama with two big SEC road wins and a two ranking, why Nick Saban doesn't want to hear how good his team is.
Al Davis knows football is just 60s and 70s football.
Warren Sapp doesn't dance around Al Davis. Why Aaron Rodgers is under the most pressure this week, and will T.O. or Chad Johnson be the star in Dallas? SportsCenter, right out.
See ya! A grand slam, Shane Victorino.
How's it? Welcome to SportsCenter. Alongside Scott Van Pelt, I'm Neil Everett. You never forget your first.
For a whole bunch of Rays fans, are you talking about the first time they ever actually went to the Chop to see him play?
Yeah. No, not that. I'm talking about their first playoff game. But you're talking about some of the fans.
Nice of them to fill the Chop. What a day it was as the Rays playing the playoffs for the very first time. Ozzie Guillen showing some love. Welcome to the show, fellas. You deserve it. Carlos Pena here, strikes out swinging in the bottom of the first. Had to leave the game, blurry vision, scratched his eye at home last night. Evan Longoria's vision is 20-20. Javier Vasquez grooves the fastball. This young man does not miss fastballs. Take another look here. AJ setting up outside. That has got the fat part of the plate and the fat part of the bat. Longoria, 22 years old, the youngest American League third baseman to hit a postseason home run. He was far from finished. Top three, two on, two out. Dwayne Wise facing James Shields. Deuces wild, 2-2 pitch. Two on, two outs. And now let's bring three runs home for the South Side nine. White Sox lead 3-1, but these Rays, pesky bunch. Aki Iwamura up with a man on, nobody out. Over the head of Ken Griffey Jr. in center. Jason Bartlett comes in to score. Iwamura slides in with a triple. It's 3-2, and Iwamura would come home to tie things up on a sacrifice fly. Still bottom three. Longoria up. Don't want to hang a fastball, but you don't want to hang a breaking ball either. Young fella said he was nervous. Really? He hardly looks it. Another home run. Joe Madden. All he can do is smile and be, well, I'm happy he's on my squad. One more look at this, and look at him wait. Wait on that breaking ball, and then pound it. The second player to hit a home run in his first two postseason at-bats, Gary Gaetti, the other. It's 4-3 Rays. Next at-bat, well, at least they kept him in the yard. Bottom five, Longoria with an RBI single. B.J. Upton comes roaring around. 5-3 Rays. Longoria 3-for-3. Two homers, three RBIs. Vasquez in another big spot comes up small. He was done after 4 1/3. Six earned. Carl Crawford facing Clayton Richard. Charlie Brown's in right through the wickets back up the middle. Willie Ivar scores 6-3 Rays. Carl Crawford said, it feels like you're in a dream. This is for real. Bases loaded for Juan Uribe. Grant Balfour goes high, can't get it with the bases loaded. Orlando Cabrera, the first pitch from Balfour, and Cabrera sort of kicks dirt and starts yelling at Balfour. Started a little chit-chat that got heated in a hurry. Check it out. It's outside. I don't know what's that about. And Balfour says, what exactly is your, well, he said, what's your problem?
Earmuffs.
He asked what his problem was, but he was a little bit more animated than the 2-2 pitch and said, sit down. Gives him the gas face. The Tampa dugout explodes. Inning over. Ninth inning. Dan Wheeler on to try to close it. Troy Percival left off the ALDS roster. Tightness in his back. Paul Konerko leads off. 3-2 pitch, and that is smashed. Got the catwalks, got those crazy ground rules, but that stayed just low enough and plenty far enough to make it 6-4. Same score. Two outs, A.J. Pierzynski, he gives it a ride, but that'll stay in the yard. That's it, and that's all. And the Rays in their very first playoff game in front of some brand-new fans who might have needed to have the ground rules explained to them. They get the win. The White Sox see their eighth game postseason winning streak snapped. Tampa Bay relievers did a lights-out job. They struck out five of the eight they faced, and the regular season trend continues.